What you're doing?
Thank you.
Blue is cheap.
Dirter. Thank you.
Hello. Without a doubt, you came here today to learn about
the most extraordinary group of animals that have ever appeared on this planet, the dinosaurs. But today,
in contrast to those magnificent beasts, the creature we will be examining is admittedly less impressive, even puny in stature, at less than 2 meters tall. It is a paleontologist. Normally, it is illusory, but now, using the latest in streaming technology,
we can see for ourselves. Shall we?
Hello there, everybody. And welcome back to Paleontologizing.
Feeding almost entirely on plants, it has no sharp claws or fearsome teeth.
There you go.
Being so preoccupied with the study of ancient life, the fossil scientist seems to exist only to dig up, examine, and discuss fossils.
The same dinosaur.
Although many of his current archaea and retrosive powers here has learned to communicate over vast distances, broadcasting his strange sounds far and wide.
Ankylosaurus and Triceratops, Tyrannosaurus Rex. It is indeed true, in human face bone, birds are dinosaurs.
His bizarre display is fascinating to watch. Creatures like this are quite rare, requiring very specific conditions to survive.
Thanks for the hydrate. Welcome to Paleontology. Pretty cool, right?
So that it does not die out like the fossil organisms which it studies, we must work to protect this rare and curious creature from extinction.
Well, hello, hello, everybody, and welcome back to Paleontologizing. It's really good to have you here. And happy National Elephant Day to all of you. Maybe especially if you live in Thailand, because apparently that's where it is actually National Elephant Day. We might as well call it International Elephant Day, though, because you know what? We're celebrating it here. Protected by massive plates of bony armor. Diagonal, thank you. Thank you for the 37 months of support. I really appreciate that. Thank you for celebrating that 37-month anniversary with us, Diagonal. That's pretty impressive. Appreciate you. We might as well call it International Elephant Day, because we're also celebrating it here on Paleontologizing. We're gonna have a fun stream today. It's gonna be pretty elephant-centric. I started a little bit late today, because I had a lot of stuff to get ready. Had to read a new scientific paper that Blint emailed over, and we're going to be discussing that at the end of today's stream when I raid into science streams. That's going to be a ton of fun. But yeah, in the meantime, we're going to be talking about elephants. We're going to be talking about mammoths and mastodons. We're going to be talking about gomphotheres, Marotherium, Erotherium? What is the most ancestral proboscidean now? We're going to be learning all that stuff. It's going to be a fun stream. We're going to be learning about what makes elephants special, what we can do to protect them nowadays, and we might even get into the whole controversy surrounding de-extincting the mammoth. And you'll get my take on that as well. But, and of course, Bella Messina, I'm sure there will be more than a few Simpsons references today, if history is any guide. Yes, indeed. So I'm glad you're here, everybody. Whether you love elephants and you already know a ton about them, or whether you're just kind of elephant curious and would like to learn more about them, to gain a better understanding and appreciation for these incredible animals, which used to be so much more diverse than they are today, you're in the right place. So I'm glad you're here. Welcome to Paleontologize. Let me scroll up to the top of chat real quick and let's say hello to everybody. I think we've already lost the very top of chat, but that's okay. I'll start from the top as it exists now. Saranlin, how are you doing? Bella Messina. Lenina, how are you doing, Lenina? Welcome, welcome. I am Morvash. How you doing? Beekeeping it real. Howdy, howdy, beekeeping. Hello, hello, Bojangle Jenkins. It's good to see you too. Grim Deviant. What's shaking, Claire Burr? How are you doing, Claire? Thank you for everything you do. It's good to see you as always, Claire Burr. Hope you're having a good day. We've got Eddie Scarin. We've got Orchestran. We've got Matt M33. We've got Patrick Crusader. And we've got Celtic Elephant. I'm glad you're here, Celtic Elephant. This stream, I really hope you enjoy. Curtis Pucka, how are you doing? Howdy, howdy. Samich Nom Nom, glad to have you back. Kodali, what's shaking with you, Kodali? Good to have you here. And Golganak, did I say hello to you yet? Welcome, welcome, Golganak. Hope you're having a lovely day. It's always good to see you, Golganak. And I said that 60-month streak there. 60 months? 60 streams. Might as well be 60 months. Holy cow. I've not even been streaming for that long, though. Golganak, wonderful to see you, as always. I hope you're having a good day. And Dinosaur Dave, going into the Fossil Hall at the Melbourne Museum. A very, very cool Dinosaur Dave. And happy, happy birthday to you. Holy cow. Dinosaur Dave, that is very, very exciting. I hope it's a wonderful one, Dinosaur Dave. And here's to another excellent trip around the sun. Hope this next one is your best one yet. Hugh Fun is back. Howdy, howdy, Hugh Fun. And who else? Salamander, did I say hello to you yet? Welcome, welcome, Salamander. It's good to see you. Brings a smile to my face. Yeah. I did not know about that disease that elephant calves can get, Eddie Scarin. That sounds grim. Yeah, it was we might learn about that today. Jermaine G, how are you doing? Hello, hello. Yeah. Ivory hunters were scared of elephants back in the day and believed that saying the word elephant would make them appear out of nowhere and go rampant. I hope that elephants appeared out of nowhere and trampled ivory hunters into the ground. in a video game. Paleolord, it's good to see you. Welcome, welcome. I'm glad you could be here. For a rare proboscidean stream today. Shoot, I forgot to introduce myself. Where are my manners? If anybody's here for the very first time, then let me introduce myself real quick. My name is Danny Anduza. I'm a dinosaur paleontologist. So a paleontologist is a fossil scientist. I work on dinosaur fossils in particular. Most paleontologists do not work on dinosaurs. We're actually kind of a rare breed, honestly, when it comes to paleontology. Even though dinosaurs get a ton of attention, dinosaurs are but the tip of the iceberg when it comes to fossil science. Paleontology is the study of fossils in general. Everything from fossil bacteria to fossil insects, fossil mammals, fossil amphibians, fossil plants, fossil fungi, and then of course we have dinosaurs too. As a dinosaur guy, you know, I sometimes when I'm trying to convey the size of some of the larger dinosaurs to a lay audience, I talk about it in terms of elephants. Like, yes, these largest of sauropods probably weighed more than about 10 or 12 elephants. 10 or 12, like, African bull elephants. So, yeah. Anyway, elephants got pretty big, too. Very respectable by mammal standards. We'll be talking about that today. It could be the largest land mammals of all time may have been elephants. Paleoloxodon, I think, might... It's controversial, but it might take the cake for the largest terrestrial mammal ever. Yeah. Anyway, we'll be talking about that more today. I've never really dug fossil mammals, though I might be sometime soon. You know, I take that back. I've dug a few fossil mammals before, but they've been Mesozoic mammals, which tend to be about the size of a, you know, a small tangerine. The largest mammal fossil I've ever dug is probably about that big. It was like a femur of a little fossil mammal. That's the largest bone in the body, by the way. Well, actually, no, sometimes their denary is bigger. Their lower jawbone. What am I saying? Their mandible. Anyway. Elephants get big by mammal standards. We'll be talking about that today. Then Freelancer says, celebrated my birthday yesterday. Well, happy, happy birthday to you too, Freelancer. I hope it was an excellent one. Yeah. Alzora, you bet we're talking about mammoths and mastodons. They are indeed kind of elephant. We'll be talking about elephants in general. There's this lovely piece of artwork by Mark Hallett right there. And we'll be examining this as well, talking about the long and storied fossil history of elephants. It's like close to 200 species of elephants that have been named. Almost all of them fossil species, obviously. But yeah. I don't know who that is, Fall Machine. What? That was David Attenborough, like, generative voice thing. Timmer's Crutch, how are you doing? Welcome, welcome. Dr. Irrefutable says you're looking well, Denny. Thank you, Dr. Irrefutable. I would say the same to you, but I can't see you, so I'll say your typing looks good, Dr. Irrefutable, and I'm glad you're here. I hope you're looking well today. I'm sure you are. It's good to have you. A Small Boiled Egg says hello, one and all, and hello to you, A Small Boiled Egg. Welcome back. I dig that elephant emoji there. Good stuff. Yeah. And Science Streams, Balint, you were up there somewhere too. Balint, I can't wait for our crossover later. I only read the B paper. Man, it's been a busy day. But, glad you're here. And I'm looking forward to our crossover in a little bit. Yeah. Let's see. Linnea says Stampy equals my eldest kiddo. Really? Likes to stamp around, stomp around. Thing one of two. How are you doing? Welcome, welcome. It's good to have you here. Lady Fiend. Howdy. Howdy to you also. Hope your day has been good so far. And Rachel Darling Endeavor says, I'm super excited for the elephant stream. I'm glad you're here. Welcome, welcome. Yeah. But yeah. Yeah, Rusty Guy. I hope you're doing well. It is good to see you. And, did we have Rocket Sage here? Is that why you're giving her a shout-out, Claire? Is Sage watching right now? That would be lovely. Let's see. Jermaine G says, like rodents? What are like rodents? If you're talking about Mesozoic mammals, rodents didn't actually evolve until after the extinction of the non-bird dinosaurs. And most of the birds too, honestly. Yeah, there were no rodents yet. But Mesozoic mammals were mostly pretty small critters. Yeah. Sick thing, thank you for the hydrate. Appreciate that. It's good to see you. Ironbark72, how are you doing? Welcome, welcome. Baja Spencer, if I said hello to you yet? If not, hello. If I have, hello again. But yeah. Yeah. And Tibo Tube, I'm not sure what you're asking there, but I'm glad you're here. Welcome, welcome. Tolkien Otaku, elephants indeed. Yes, indeed. Yeah. Anywho, yeah. Oh, she shouted us out a quarter hour ago. Very nice. Thank you, Claire. I appreciate that. Yeah, if you'd like to see a real-life geologist streaming here on Twitch, go check out Rocket Sage. She might be live right now. Anyway. Tippo Tube says, "Watch stone are you wearing?" Oh, this is a sample of coal. This is the Z coal layer. The iridium layer from the end of the Age of Dinosaurs. There's a command about it there. You can see it there. Yeah. Anyway, Mayor of Space, it's good to see you as well, Mayor of Space. Howdy, howdy. I hope you're having a good day so far, Mayor of Space. We, of course, are talking about elephants today. Not a very good elephant sound, but... it is National Elephant Day in Thailand, apparently. I'm gonna celebrate it anyway. And today's your birthday. Well, happy birthday to you, Tibo Tube. Holy cow. You and elephants both have something to celebrate today, I suppose. I love this. So apparently elephants are considered the national animal of Thailand. I think they used to be on the flag of Thailand as well. And look at them chowing down on that spread there. Potatoes and corn. And are those cucumbers? Oh, that is some good stuff. An interesting Charlie's Dragon, yeah. They are very much adorned here, and probably a little bit more groomed than your typical elephant. Yeah. Here we go. Let me find another video here. Hang on, we have some music from an elephant. Playing the old Louisiana saxophone. Well, well, well.
Today, we affixed a harmonica to the training wall and installed one so that Shanti could play it if she chooses. Shanti is our 36-year-old Asian female given to us as a gift from Sri Lanka and mother of our 10-year-old cat, Pondo.
Oh, do you know this elephant?
I think Shanti's musically inclined. When Shanti interacts with her environment, her indoor stalls and her outside area, she likes to tap on things with the tip of her trunk. She likes to flap her ears against things that make noise. She likes to rub her leg up and down brushes and repeat that noise. So we thought, why not go to harmonicas and horns and toys that she could blow and make sound with?
Huh. Well, well, well. So cool.
What I'd like the visitors to know is I don't make Shanti play the harmonica. Although sometimes in a training demonstration, I might put a harmonica up and ask Shanti to blow through it to show the public what she can do. We also install harmonicas and horns and other noisemakers that she's able to interact with all on her own for her own pleasure and joy. That has nothing to do with me. I'm not even around sometimes. Keepers are off doing other things, and she's playing a full-on song that she's come up with all by herself.
Well, well, well. Recently, the elephant keepers were giving another elephant a bath when they heard Shanti practicing the harmonica in a nearby stall. They quickly grabbed a camera to capture it on video. Shanti is in no way being cued to start or stop, blow or inhale. Very cool.
What's really amazing about the little ditties that Shanti comes up with is musically, they really do have a beginning, a middle, and an end. They have a repetitive part that might have some beat that you could actually follow to it, and it has a big crescendo at the end, and we all know there's going to be a crescendo. And we wait, and then we applaud, and then we go back to work. And it's just so enjoyable.
We offer the elephants opportunities to do the same things that they would do in the wild here at the zoo or park. Only they get to do them here for pleasure almost. And in the wild, they have to do them to survive. I really do think that they have playtime. They're smart enough to have downtime.
Oh,
they don't have to spend every moment of their day looking for enough food and searching for things and, you know, looking around to survive. They live in big groups of large animals. There are not too many predators that are going to come after a herd of elephants, a large mom, even a calf. So, I mean, we need to occupy their time with fun things for them to do that make them happy, that's enjoyable.
Take the phone to mommy now.
It's the
dinosaur man.
Okay.
Daisy McGar, thank you for the 3 months of support. I do really appreciate that. Thank you. We're having a good day so far. Happy National Elephant Day. Let's finish this video out. This is lovely. Thank you,
Daisy. If it's that important to our brain, these really intelligent animals ought to enjoy music.
Yeah. And they do enjoy music. They do indeed. pretty excellent. Let's see, elephant. Listening to piano. This is pretty lovely. Take a look at this. So this is from Paul Barton. He's got a bunch of videos like this on YouTube. Sounds like a Dark Maw Crisis, yeah. Holy moly. Description. Debussy Clair de Lune for a gentle female elephant called Empen. Empen is 80 years old and lives with us at Elephant's World in Thailand. She is blind in one eye and can barely see with the other. 80 years old is very old indeed for an elephant. It's about 10 years past the natural lifespan of an elephant in the wild. This is an Asian elephant, wombat hole, especially if they're in Thailand. I thought I only saw one finger projection on the trunk, too. African elephants have two, one on top and one below. Asian elephants just have one. Yeah, her ears look much more like an Asian elephant, also. Yeah, She does have biggish ears, yeah. I think that might just be because she's older, though. I think maybe like elephants, like us, elephants, their ears just seem larger when they're older. They might continue to grow as the animals age through ontogeny. That's pretty lovely right there. Yeah, see one finger on the trunk there. Oh. Pretty lovely. Elephants are pretty incredible critters. That's why I'm excited to talk about them today. There's a link to that video there. Yeah. And their teeth are something that we're going to talk about. Because they are different from the teeth of other kinds of critters. Let's take a look at this video here. Apologies to anybody watching this in the VOD or on YouTube later. This part will be muted for you, but all of you lucky viewers who are watching live get to hear the sound. I don't want to get copyright nuked on YouTube, so I gotta do this. The Real Animatron, hey, thank you for the follow. Welcome to Paleontologizing. It's good to have you here. Holy cow. That's like over 600 pounds of food. Yeah, the trunk is such an amazing adaptation. So this is an African elephant, obviously. African savanna elephant, or I think it's also called African bush elephant. One of three species of living elephant. Yep. Do you see that? Those two fingers right there that they have on the trunk? Check that out. African elephants have got one on top and one below. They've got two. Check that out. Hey, Amish Andy. Welcome, welcome. Yep, they could pick a dime off of a countertop with that trunk. Yep. Pretty extraordinary. Hey, Kelodon K, welcome, welcome. Right or left trunked? I know that it's true. The tusks, at least, Amish Andy, they'll favor one or the other. And we'll see, Eddie Scarron. We'll see. Yeah. Some great camera work there. Holy cow. And no evidence of that broken symmetry. Although we could talk about that. Why don't we talk about that real quick before we dive into tusks? There is an old idea that maybe sauropod dinosaurs, by virtue of their retracted nares, may have had trunks almost like an elephant or something. So, elephants, of course, don't have any bones inside of that trunk. It's just soft tissue in there. But the front of an elephant's skull has got these enormous nostrils right there. And that's both an anchor point for the muscles of the trunk, and also just like openings for the nasal passages that go through the trunk into the skull. Which you can kind of see right there. Now, there are certain dinosaurs that also have almost a superficially similar kind of thing going on. me show you. This will work for now. Got a little Camarasaurus right here. So Camarasaurus is a big old sauropod dinosaur, the most common sauropod dinosaur in the Morrison Formation. Camarasaurus. Yeah, pretty neat animal. One of the better known of our North American dinosaurs, I would say. Oh, that's a lovely illustration there. Paleo stock. Nice. Now, when you're looking at the skull of these guys, this right here is the nose. So they have this huge nares, this huge bony nostril right there. And then here is the eye socket right here. So, eye socket, the eyeball would be right here. And this whole thing is just the nose. And these have been reconstructed in different ways. We think that they had like a little fleshy tube that ran down to about here, so the nostril would actually be about there, like the fleshy nostril. So fleshy tube goes there into that big bony nares. And you kind of see that in some of these illustrations, like right there. Yeah, that's pretty well done, all things considered. Even if I don't like the color scheme that much, that's... Yeah. But there's an old idea that dinosaurs like this, like Camarasaurus, or like Apatosaurus, aka Brontosaurus, or say Diplodocus, there's an idea that maybe their skull looks like that because it actually supported a fleshy trunk. You see, like this. Or like this. Or like this. The thing is, we don't have any evidence of this whatsoever. We don't really have the right kind of like muscle scarring that would imply that a trunk was there. Nor are these animals that would really benefit from a trunk. They've already got a stupidly long neck. It wouldn't really seem to make much sense that they would then have just a short little trunk at the end of a super, super long neck with a super tiny head. Just biologically, it doesn't seem to make a lot of sense. But here we go. Yeah. There is an old Bakker illustration of what this might look like. Right there. This is Diplodocus right here. Fleshy trunk. I don't think Bakker was actually arguing for this in earnest, but... it's just kind of fun as like a thought experiment. But we don't have any evidence that this is the case. Yeah. But yeah. Yeah. And anteaters or Saiga antelopes would be a good comparison to those hypothetical trunks. Well, with anteaters, they actually have a really long skull. Like, their snout is really long. Yeah. But Saiga antelope would be a better analogy, yeah. Yeah. But with them, they have a bunch of, like, nasal turbinates and stuff in there, and it almost seems like their, you know, a big fleshy nose is more of like a dust filter. Because they tend to live in very arid environments. Dust filter, and also like a way to heat incoming air, because they also did really, really well in the cold, like during the last ice age. But yeah, there's a Saiga antelope right there. It's a cool critter. It's a really cool critter.
Hello. The creature we will be examining is a paleontologist.
Well, hello, hello, GeoJim. Welcome, welcome, GeoJim and Raiders. I hope you're doing well. Welcome back to Paleontologizing. How was your stream? Hope it was really good. Happy National Elephant Day to all of you. GeoJim, tell me how your stream went. Or Raiders, tell me how the stream went. It's good to have you here. I had a really good one. Yeah. We were just discussing the idea that maybe sauropod dinosaurs had trunks, kind of like elephants, but it doesn't really seem to make a lot of sense given their overall biology. Elephants then have a very short neck, and a trunk is what allows them to kind of manipulate their environment, pick things up off the ground, drink water. Sauropods, you know, if they've got a 30-foot long neck with a tiny, teeny little head at the end, having a little short trunk on the end of that head just doesn't seem to make a lot of sense. These guys could already drink pretty easily. They could already move their head way down to the ground or way up into the trees or whatever else. Having that extra bit of trunk at the end just doesn't seem to make a lot of sense. Even after we consider that, shoot, there doesn't seem to be any soft tissue evidence for this at all. Muscle scarring on the face doesn't really imply that they had a trunk or anything like that, so... yeah. Yeah. But yeah. Yeah. And... oh, there you go, Charlie's Dragon. Yeah. Yeah. There are unusual dinosaur soft tissue features that do pop up when we have exceptional preservation. But so far, no trunks or anything like that. Yeah. More the sorts of things you would expect to see in, like, birds, you know? Cool, showy feathers, or, you know, like, head crests, stuff like that. So, yeah. Yeah. Celtic Elephant says it also takes a long time to learn how to use that trunk. I believe it. Yeah. Elephants with their famously, like, K-strategy animals in terms of, like, reproduction and population growth and stuff like that. You know, they're having very few young and heavily investing in them. And that means their young have to take a long time to develop. And elephants actually have culture that they share with one another, which is pretty cool. So yeah. Yeah. Anyway, speaking of elephants and how cool they are, let's get back to this right here and start talking about their tusks a bit. Yep. Those are... yeah, all I want for Christmas is my two front teeth. That's what an elephant's tusks are. Those are its incisors and the upper jaw. Right there off the premaxillary bone. Pretty cool. Pretty impressive. This is one of the reasons why they're called ecosystem engineers, is, you know, they suit their habitat to their own needs. They'll knock over a tree if they want to eat the leaves off the top and it's too tall. You know, they'll dig out a hole in the ground in order to get to groundwater or whatever else they want to do. They will do it. They're exerting power over their surroundings in a way that few other animals can do nowadays. It's pretty cool. Yeah. And this is really, really cool. This is why I was most excited to show you this video. This part right here, the way that the teeth come in is different from almost any other mammal. Most mammals have got two sets of teeth for their entire lives. You've got your milk teeth or your baby teeth in us humans. And then you've got your adult teeth, and then you're done, you know? This is a thing that, like, shoot, we've talked about this before, but elephants do break that rule. Yes, indeed, Claire Burr. Let's see. There we go. Let me just find you the exact spot. In this, talking about mammals and their teeth. And here it is. Yeah.
These ancient innovations were the precursors to the molars we have in our mouths today.
We've watched this before, but I think it's worth revisiting for anybody who hasn't seen it before.
Right, a mouth of molars. Couldn't eat the apple. Mouth of incisors. I couldn't eat the whatever you call this. It's good, by the way.
Guava roll.
Guava roll. Thank you for having molars, because I'm glad I could do this one.
You know, but the humble tooth is very important for our lives today.
Yep. Teeth are extraordinarily important to mammals.
Right, that is a very complex behavior. Our front of our teeth, the incisors, bite into that apple, and they do so in almost a perfect way. The teeth occlude in a very fixed pattern, a very precise pattern.
Mm-hmm. That kind of precision is so important to mammals.
We rely on specialized teeth. Tooth-to-tooth occlusion, except when things go wrong, except when we crack a tooth or something like that. Good luck to you. Make sure everything is where it's supposed to be. And there's nothing in here that isn't supposed to be. Wonderfully complex teeth might allow us to have a great bite, but it's come at a price.
You know, one of the things that's interesting to think about is, you know, the consequences of the reptile mammal transition are the fact that we need dentists.
Really thank true. You.
You're right. Thanks. Thank you, South African that's fossils. Right.
Thank you very much.
I mean, reptiles don't need dentists, right? Because they're producing lots of teeth throughout their lives. You know,
yep.
Boom, boom, boom. And they produce them, they're out of there.
So, like, dinosaurs were like this. You know, dinosaurs, the ones that had teeth, because some of them lost teeth altogether, but most dinosaurs had teeth, and they're just constantly replacing their teeth all the time. They had basically an unlimited set of teeth throughout their lifespan. As long as they're alive, they are producing new teeth. We mammals are not the same way. We've got two sets of teeth for our entire lifespan. Elephants kind of cheat that system in a really interesting way, which we'll get to. But first, I want to lay the groundwork and talk about how it works in most mammals.
Most reptiles, like the snake, grow multiple sets of teeth in their lifetime. There's a constant stream of new teeth erupting in their mouths.
Yep.
But after we lose our baby teeth, we're left with one adult set to last us the rest of our lives.
It's better take care of it.
This may not seem like the best of strategies, but there is a plus side. It allows us to develop our very precise bite.
Yep.
If you're continually replacing your teeth, right? I mean, I think
it is like a case strategy
to
for teeth, Charlie's Dragon.
You know,
yeah.
Micron scale occlusion, which is so really important to us.
Oh, and Azura says, so I asked my dentist buddy why, if teeth require so much upkeep or work, why don't we just replace our teeth with full, stronger, longer lasting dentures? Turns out they are both incredibly difficult to implant well in one socket, much less across the whole mouth. Yes, absolutely. Yeah. And also, you're not going to have the same kind of feel with dentures as you would with your actual teeth, because there are nerve endings and stuff in there. Like, you can still feel things with your teeth that you wouldn't be able to feel with dentures, you know? So you would actually lose a lot. That's why it's best to just, you know, take care of the teeth that you have. And thank your parents and grandparents if you've got a good set of teeth that don't require too much upkeep. I know people who have all kinds of tooth problems, even when they try to take really good care of their teeth. Some of the stuff is still genetic. Or maybe epigenetic or environmental or whatever. But yeah. And Diagonal says, most other animals swallow chunks of food. Mammals are the only group that chews their food before swallowing? No, there are other animals that do that too. Dinosaurs. There are a lot of different groups of dinosaurs that also chewed their food. We'll be talking about this a bit more on National Flower Day when we talk about the evolution of angiosperms. But,
Forest.
This'll do it. Yeah. Here, take a look.
The river estuary provides them with an ideal break in the forest.
So several groups of dinosaur and the banks here are evolved the ability to chew
scrub and tree ferns.
So this is Iguanodon here.
One reason Iguanodon are so successful is that they have developed a new way of tackling Cretaceous plants. Most dinosaurs can only crudely slice food with their teeth, But Iguanodon are the first herbivores to have back teeth that can grind up vegetation before swallowing.
This so yeah, about halfway through the age of dinosaurs.
Speeds digestion of even the toughest plant material.
About halfway through the age of dinosaurs, certain groups of Ornithischian dinosaur. None of the Saurischians, only Ornithischians. Iguanodontians, like Iguanodonts and Hadrosaurs. And Ceratopsians, the horned dinosaurs, evolved the ability to actually chew their food in a thorough and efficient way like this. Pretty cool. Yeah.
The forests near the equator are also witness to another landmark in evolution.
Oh, we'll be talking about this.
Simple flowers have arrived.
Yeah, we'll be talking about this on when? Next Thursday, we'll be talking about the evolution of angiosperms on National Flower Day. And we'll be doing Thursday Birds Day as well. I'll be starting early that day also, because I'm leaving on a trip right after stream. But, Charlie's Dragon says, we don't need to cook our food, except to sanitize it sometimes or make it edible. But it makes it easier to digest and get more energy out of it, which is good since our brain needs a lot of energy. Yes, Charlie's Dragon, chewing is almost like pre-digesting your food to get more nutrients out of it too. Cooking is like pre-digesting it. Oh yeah. Yeah. Anyway. Yeah. So anyway, we're talking about teeth here.
You're right. When we lose a tooth, the changes that occur to compensate for the loss of that tooth and the space that it held has a profound effect on our inclusions.
And thank you for dropping in there, Boxing Elephant. Happy National Elephant Day to you. Welcome to Paleontologizing. I'm guessing, maybe presuming by your name, you appreciate elephants. I do too. I'm a dinosaur paleontologist, so dinosaurs are actually what I study and everything, but elephants are also super cool, and I'm jumping at the chance to talk about them today. We're going to be talking about fossil elephants, the evolution of the elephant group, mammoths and mastodons and Marotherium and all these other critters, and then modern elephants also. But right now we're talking about teeth. First of all, and Victarius, thank you for that gift sub.
Victorious gifted a tier 1 sub to Boxing Elephant.
Thank you, Victarius.
135 gift subs in the channel.
I really appreciate that. Thank you, Victarius. And look, you're helping out with our sub goal, too. We're almost a quarter of the way there. Excellent.
The reason our rows of teeth match up so precisely.
And thank you, Lenina. We'll do Metazoa, too.
Reduced the number of sets that they produced. We've made up for that by strengthening our teeth with extra roots and thick enamel to help them last a lifetime. Along with a little help from our dentists.
That's neat. I'll have to take a better look when I go to the zoo with my kids. The reptile house is not my favorite place.
Yeah,
here,
it's
so.
Not
I would like them in the form you find them.
Dead?
Yeah, dead 200 million years.
Dentists not appreciating the reptiles. Anyway, the reason I wanted to show you that is so that we could jump to this and talk about elephant teeth and how elephants do really, really interesting things with their teeth. They kind of cheat the mammal system a little bit, where we only have two sets of teeth for our entire lives. Elephants have got 6 or 7, I think. Check this out. This is really, really cool. Yep. Holy cow. Like this. Here, I'll show you in a minute. Yep. So elephants are grazers. So elephants eat a lot of really tough food. They eat a lot of grass, a lot of bark, a lot of stuff like that. Grass especially is full of silica. And then there's a lot of grit that gets into their mouth too when they're feeding at ground level like this. They're getting sand and they're getting dirt and silt and stuff in there, and that helps grind down their enamel. So they have to have really, really tough teeth, but even that is not enough. They've got another trick up their sleeves. And Sheridanicus, thank you for that gift sub there. Ryan UK, I'm sure, appreciates that very much, Sherrod Danicus, and I do too. Thank you. Thank you for your generosity. Appreciate that. Yeah, and they do eventually. Yeah, we'll talk about that. And Science Streams. Thank you for those 100 bits. I appreciate that. Getting the hype train kicked off there. Science Streams, you got some good aim there. That's excellent. Thank you. Thank you, Science Streams. And thank you, Lenina, for that gift sub.
No expense.
I appreciate that.
Lenina gifted a tier 1 sub to Sawopo.
Excellent.
1,000 bits can make a wonderful difference in promoting the appreciation and understanding of fossil science here on Twitch.
Thank you. Thank you, Ironbark72, for the 1,500 bits. That is splendid, and I really appreciate it. Holy cow. Thank you. Thank you for that. Where are we at right now on our hype train? Level 1 complete. Beautiful. We're almost halfway to a level 2 now. Fantastic. And look, we are, we're almost a quarter of the way to our sub goal.
Dinosaurs became extinct because they no longer knew how to love each other. Is that correct?
No, that's not correct. What?
Exactly. And I certainly wouldn't want our species to end the same way.
Michael Elf, or Michael F01, thank you, thank you. Michael F01 for the 8 months of support there. I do really appreciate that. Thanks for keeping me here online for the past 8 months. Good stuff. Yeah. But yeah. Yeah, excellent. Fantastic. Here, should we get back into elephant teeth here? Let's do it. Yeah. Yep. This is like back in the elephant's neck. They should have put that forward a little bit, but whatever. It's kind of weird looking. Yep. Yep. They've got marching molars. This is so cool. Yep, and then they get ground down. Yep. Isn't that neat, Rachel Darling? Yeah. Yeah, very, very cool stuff. They do sometimes need help, though. Check this out. Right here.
We've all known the pain of a mammoth toothache, but perhaps none quite as much as Luca the elephant.
Aww.
Keepers at Whipsnade Zoo in Bedfordshire were concerned when Luca stopped eating properly before deciding it was time for a visit from the dentist.
Oh, wow.
Capturing the whole procedure on camera, Dr. Peter Cortez, who's more used to asking people to say ah, removed a colossal troubling tooth from this very grateful giant.
Wow.
And what became apparent was that this tooth was in the wrong position and not moving forward and dropping out as it should. So...
yeah, shoot, so this is what we were talking about. Those teeth need to move forward in order for the new tooth to kind of take its place like that. Yowza. Yeah. Oh, and very cool, Caledon cave. This is the same one? Excellent.
Well, what we think had happened is it had rotated forwards like this, and this front portion of the roots are starting to resorb, and it was quite infected around here as well.
As for the procedure, well, if you think your dentist drills are scary, check out this, guys.
Oh,
the
my
easily
goodness.
Squeamish should look away now.
Oh, wow.
The whole procedure took about 2 hours. So that included removing this tooth, doing a little bit of work on the tooth below to flatten the coronal surface of that, and then to recover her.
Don't worry, though. Luca was fast asleep throughout the entire process. And the result? Well, how do we all feel after a trip to the dentist?
Oh.
Happy, hungry, and hopeful.
Is this real life?
Before she sees that drill again.
Elephant after dentist.
Yeah.
I feel fine.
Kind of felt good, didn't it?
Is this real life?
Yeah, this is real life.
That's basically what our elephant friend was
We've
doing right there.
The pain of a...
At the end.
Before she sees that drill again.
Yeah, looking a little loopy
well,
here, maybe.
How do we all feel after a trip to the dentist? Happy, hungry, and hopeful that it'll be a long while before she sees that drill again.
Yeah. So anyway, elephant teeth are really neat, and they're also kind of an easy shortcut for telling a mammoth from a mastodon, which I'll tell you about in a little bit. But we've got this here, discussing elephant teeth. What is this about?
I'd like to tell you a little bit about elephant teeth. A lot of people often ask questions about the teeth of elephants and especially how many teeth they get in their life. And it's led to a lot of confusion because, of course, all the experts and so on know. But for the average layman, when they see an elephant skull like this, this is the lower jaw of an elephant, they will look at this tooth over here, or this row of teeth, and they'll say, wow, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. They've got lots of teeth in their mouth.
These closed captions are not helping. What is up with this? Dutch auto-generated. No. No. Options. Dutch auto-generated. No. It's not speaking Dutch. That might be like a South African accent or like Afrikaner accent or something. Maybe that's why it thinks it's Dutch. And I'm just going to turn those off. They're no help. Sorry.
But in fact, if you look at it from the side, this whole thing is actually just one tooth.
Yeah, that's a molar right there.
It's these enamel ridges.
A lot like our mammoth tooth here.
Cementum type material. Yeah. And it essentially is coming from a single rootstock. Now, what makes elephants quite different to humans and other mammals is that the teeth don't actually erupt from the bottom.
That's funny,
so they're not
Marley,
coming
yeah.
up and pushing the existing tooth out from below. Elephants' teeth actually work by pushing from the back, and you can actually see here how the new tooth is actually pushing through from the back of the jaw. Can see it on this side over here.
Very cool.
So the best analogy
you might look at that and go like, oh man, that must hurt, like both like the tooth pushing its way up through the but that's the same way that our teeth erupt. That's how we develop our teeth throughout our lifespan, you know.
The way to think of this is to think of a conveyor belt where, you know, the new tooth is actually pushing the existing tooth forward as it sort of comes into
it. Does
the
hurt
mouth.
A bit
each
Claire,
successive
yeah.
tooth
yeah.
is ultimately going to be
it's
sort
not
of
unbearable
bigger.
Or anything.
You know, broader, higher, wider than the tooth before it, because it's based on age and the skull is getting bigger and they're obviously needing to deal with more foodstuffs and so on. So as this existing tooth gets pushed forward, it gets to this sort of fragmentation edge, as I like to call it, in the front here, where you can see here where the tongue and the lower lip is. And then, as the pressure of the bite is happening and this tooth moves forwards, it eventually fragments and fractures over here and breaks and falls out onto the ground. So
wow.
in each of the sides of the mouth, the four quadrants,
within
the
minutes,
lower.
They were finding fossils.
And Mosh Matsy, thank you for the follow. Welcome to Paleontologizing. It's good to have you here.
Right section.
In
the average elephant, you're going to get six different teeth that move their way into the mouth over a lifespan. There have been, in some cases, a seventh tooth that comes through, sometimes very, very rudimentary or very poorly developed.
Huh.
But it's usually six. So
usually six teeth.
Essentially,
six sets
you know,
of teeth throughout
born
their life.
With the first set when they're very, very small jawed and small head. The new tooth sort of come into the mouth successively after that at different rates. And you very rarely will just find a single tooth in the mouth. Well, it typically doesn't happen. You're usually going to find part of one in the front, and maybe another one.
This is an African elephant, Commodore.
From the back. So there's always parts of successive sets in each quadrant at the same time. So essentially looking at the number of teeth that they have, these cheek teeth, if you want to call them that. A lot of people just call them molars. You could actually say that the first three are premolars and the last three are molars. It's totally irrelevant. It's six teeth in each of those quadrants.
Oh, are those actually homologous to premolars?
And then you've...
Wild, you see the permanent tusks.
Everybody's seen those. But elephants...
That's really interesting. So normally in mammals, like let's look at the lower jaw of a dog, let's say. There we go. Beautiful. This is exactly what I was looking for. So, this is the lower jaw of a dog. Obviously, there's the canines in the front right there. There's the ascending process right here that connects with the skull. So you've got your molars back here, and you've got your premolars here, and then you've got your incisors and your canines. So elephants, I don't think, have canines at all anymore. They do have incisors. Those become the tusks. But I guess the teeth that we are seeing right here are not actually true molars. These are essentially premolars that are right here, except they're huge, and they just take up this whole part of the jaw. And those other ones are small, and they're in here, and then later those grow and then push the other teeth out. I did not know that. I thought that they were actually just producing more and more molars until they stop. But that makes perfect sense why they have six, or in some cases seven, sets throughout their lives, is because 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 right there. Mammoth molars are, I guess, four of them are actually premolars throughout their lives, and then two of them are true molars. That is really interesting. That's really interesting. I never knew that before. Huh. Very cool, chat. Holy moly. I bet you mammal people probably already know this. It's immediately obvious to them. If I were to talk to Fisher McDarmon, you guys remember Fisher from last summer? Fisher would be like, yeah, of course, Danny. What are you talking about? Of course, they're not really they're premolars, and then they come out, and then you've got the molars that come in from behind. But yeah. Interesting. Yeah. Well, shoot, before we move on to some other topics here. Before we move on to mammoths and mastodons, why don't we do some Metazoa here? Thank you there, Saranlin, for the heads up. Oh man, we would be super lucky if our animal of the day was an elephant. Maybe we should start there for Metazoa. Although this is from yesterday, so I don't know. Give me the name of another placental mammal, chat. A carnivoran or an ungulate? We'll start with those. Some sort of carnivoran mammal or ungulate mammal. Giraffe! I like that, Smorphosaurus. I like that. Giraffes are artiodactyls. Even-toed ungulates. And, oh, no, whoop, nope, uh-uh. What we have here, it's actually just, it's a kind of fish. Or vertebrates, I guess. Eutelostomi are vertebrate animals. Yeah. So basically this is just, there's two major groups of fish in here. You've got the Actinopterygians, which are all of the bony fishes, clownfish and trout, salmon and tuna, eels, and halibut, and everything else. And then you've got the Sarcopterygians, the lobe-fin fishes, which includes coelacanths, and then lungfishes, and amphibians, reptiles, mammals, and birds, which are a kind of reptile. Let me show you what I mean. Let's go to vertebrate animals on our tree of life. Yeah. So, vertebrates right here. And then, well, I guess this would be Eutelostomi would be larger group, right? No, bony vertebrates. There we go. Yeah, so these are vertebrates with bony skeletons. So it's not all vertebrates. This actually excludes the sharks and rays and skates and chimeras, the cartilaginous fishes, elasmobranchs or chondrichthyans. But this is all of the bony vertebrates. These are, every single one of these here is a fish. I'm not joking. I'm not being facetious. These are all fish. And let me show you what I mean by that. We've got your ray-finned fishes here, which are most of the fishes that you think of when you think of fishes, you know? And then you got your lobe-finned fishes, which includes tetrapods. Tetrapods are amphibians, mammals, and reptiles. Birds, of course, being a kind of reptile. So, yeah. Yeah. So, what happened here is that we guessed giraffe, and it's like, no, it's not actually a mammal, but it is a vertebrate. So what that tells me is that it's not going to be a lobe-finned fish, it has to be a ray-finned fish. Because if it were a lobe-finned fish, a sarcopterygian, it would say sarcopterygii right here, and it doesn't. It says utelostomi. This game always gives us the most exclusive clade that includes our guess and the mystery animal. And with this, the closest we can get to is utelostomi, so we know it's in there. Boxing Elephant says, you have an awesome chat. Thank you. That is one of the kindest things you could say, Boxing Elephant.
The knowledge field isn't narrow to what we understand.
I appreciate that.
On the contrary, we stretch our understanding to try and take in the universe.
And Rebel Decibel, did you accidentally unfollow and then refollow? Thank you for doing that refollowing. Welcome, welcome. I hope you're having a good day. Yeah. Anywho, since it's a utelostome, but it's not a sarcopterygian, not a lobe-finned fish, we can be sure that our mystery animal is going to be a ray-finned fish here. So these are, you know, 99% of the animals that you think of when you think of fishes. Basically, all of the fishes except for lungfish and coelacanths and tetrapods, obviously. So if you're thinking of a fish right now, shout out the name of a fish, chat. A ray-finned fish. Because almost any fish that you think of, any fish that you think of is going to be a ray-finned fish, you know? Tuna, salmon, yes indeed. Clownfish, ray, rays are not ray-finned fishes. Rays are over here. They are actually cartilaginous fishes. Like a reef manta ray. I almost read for that as beef manta ray. Yeah, anglerfish, carp, halibut, yep. Yeah, bass. Dolphins are mammals, Freelancer. You know that. largemouth bass. Yeah. Where's the beef? It's not here, Commodore. I can tell you that. So let's see if it's a uteliost. The uteliosts are things like bass, pilotfish, seahorses. Let's try seahorse and see if that gets us anywhere close. Ooh, and it is a percomorph fish. It is within Percomorpha. So, that's most teleost fish are percomorphs nowadays. So, yeah, there's over 18,000 species. Let's try something like bass. And see if that gets us anywhere close. And holy cow! That's it. That's it. Not too shabby. Yeah. We got it in just 3 guesses. That's pretty good. That's pretty good. That'll hopefully make up for yesterday. A hypnogene. How are you doing? Welcome, welcome. Yeah. Basic instinct. Yes, sure. But yeah. Good stuff. Anyway. And I guess a little under an hour we can play this again because it'll reset. But today, of course, is National Elephant Day. Elephants presented with giant pyramid of food as Thailand celebrates National Elephant Day. Take a look at that. That is really lovely. From Elephant News, celebrate National Thai Elephants Day. Oh, look at these critters. Yeah. And when did elephants diverge from mammoths? That's a good question, Rebel Decibel. So, Asian elephants like this are actually closer to our woolly mammoth than either of them is to the African elephants. There are two species of African elephant, the African bush elephant and the African forest elephant. And they are kind of their own group. But Asian elephants here and mammoths are their own group also. Genus Elephas, which is the Asian elephant, and Mammuthus, which is the woolly mammoth. Mammuthus primigenius is the woolly mammoth. They are more closely allied to each other than either of them is to the African elephants, which is pretty cool, right? Yeah. Elephants are not ruminants. No, they are Afrotheres wombat hole. Oh, we should talk about that. And mastodons are kind of their own thing. A misanthrope. They are... We'll talk about that. We'll talk about that. But man, elephants used to be super diverse. There were so many different species of elephants back in the day. Today there's only three, but there have been like almost 200 species of elephants that have existed over the years that we know of. From about 40 million years ago until the present. Oh, look at them. lovely. Here, take a look at this. Yeah, this is from just 14 hours ago. Pretty lovely. Such cool critters. Such cool critters. Yeah. Good stuff. And yeah, please don't spam the chat. Fantastic. Let's talk a little bit about elephant evolution. So elephants are Afrotheres. And maybe we should talk about Afrotheres a little bit first. Afrotheria is a group that I can show you on here. We'll go out from our Actinopterygian fishes to kind of mammal called an Afrothere or Afrotheres. This is a group of mammals that includes elephants. It includes manatees and dugongs. It includes sengis, elephant shrews. It includes hyraxes. And it used to include aardvarks. I don't know if it still does. It does. It still includes aardvarks. Also tenrex, too. And golden moles. Afrotheria. So, we've got our hyraxes there. We've got our elephants here. And we've got our manatees there. And those three animals, hyraxes, manatees, and elephants, might seem very different from one another. And they are in terms of their morphology. But that's just because basically all of the creatures that used to be in between them are now extinct. This is a group that diverged, like, a long, long time ago. Before the extinction of the non-bird dinosaurs. 67 million years ago. They've had a long time to diverge. All these critters have been evolving away from each other for almost 70 million years. Which is why they look so different. And then all of the critters that are kind of in between them have since gone extinct. And that's why they seem so starkly different, is because all the in-betweens are gone. Does that make sense? Yeah. Saronlin says there's something satisfying about elephant shrews being closely related to elephants. Isn't there something cool about that? Yeah. And we'll talk about that right here. Afrotheria. Yes, indeed. Take a look at this.
If you were to ask the average person what an elephant, an aardvark, and...
Let's go back.
If you were to ask the average person what an elephant, an aardvark, and a manatee had in common, they'd probably be scratching their heads.
What is up with the closed captions today? English auto-generated into Dutch. No, English auto-generated. Why does... YouTube is a mystery sometimes, you know? Why are we on this Dutch kick now? Stick to English, please.
If you were to ask the average person what an elephant, an aardvark, and a manatee had in common, they'd probably be scratching their heads. Of course, they're all mammals, but they also belong to an order of animals known as Afrotheria.
Yeah.
This group is an ancient lineage of mammals.
And can anybody guess where the Afrotheria originated? Afrotheria. On which continent do you think this group evolved? Any guesses? Lenina says Mars. Celtic Elephant says Panama. Bahas Mansur says Pangea. Mirth says Afghanistan. Close, at least phonetically. Not Antarctica. Not France. Well, let's find out.
That encompasses a wide variety of species of different sizes, shapes, and ecological niches. Afrotheria speculated to have first emerged during the mid-Cretaceous period, roughly 105 million years ago. Africa,
yep.
Which had previously been connected to South America, began
yep.
to split apart due to plate tectonics and was isolated from the rest of the world for
it's Africa, obviously.
Million years.
Yeah.
This extended period of isolation water, resulted yeah. in the mammals that are inhabiting this continent to go through their own unique processes of evolution.
Yeah, and it is really, really neat that... Like, shoot, Afrotheres are such a cool and weird and special group that evolved here in our own home continent as humans. Africa. This is the motherland for all humanity. And it's also the motherland of the Afrotheria. Elephants. Manatees. Sengis, a.k.a. elephant shrews. Hyraxes. Tenrex. Aardvarks, etc.
The extinction of the dinosaurs at the end of the Cretaceous only allowed for a greater radiation of different and unique forms. Today, Afrotheria consists of six different orders: Macroscaletia, Afrosauricida, Tubulodentata, Hyracoidea, Proboscidea, and Sirenia.
Yeah.
The first three of these orders make up a larger family known as Afroinsectophilia, and the latter three belong to a group known as Paeungulata. Afroinsectophilia
yeah.
consists of smaller insectivorous mammals that live on the continent. Many
yep,
of these
like
animals were previously grouped together with the order
so
Insectivora,
cool.
an order that included other mammals from mice to shrews to hedgehogs, but molecular
yep.
studies indicate that these groups are not really closely related, and Insectivora is now considered a defunct order. The
yep.
first group in this order, Tubulodentata, consists of
aardvarks.
Only one species, the aardvark, consuming mostly ants and termites, which they find by digging into the ground with their hoof-like nails and pulling with their long tongues. They strongly resemble the anteaters of South America.
And they're big. People don't recognize how big, not Sengis, these guys are small, how big aardvarks are. They get big. Like, they could be large critters. You might see that and think, oh, it's small, like a bilby or something. Like, nope. That is very much, you know, it's a larger animal than you would imagine. It's like bigger than a giant anteater in a lot of cases. You know, they're not small critters, aardvarks. Look at that, you know? Yeah. So yeah, yeah. And Afro means from Africa, yeah. We've got dinosaur names like Afrovenator, which means African hunter. Afro means from Africa. Yeah. And HD says, I keep forgetting manatees evolved separately from cetaceans. Yeah! Manatees are not related to whales. They're related to elephants, which is so cool. Yeah.
The next group, Macroscelidia, contains the elephant shrews. Similar to the shrews of the order Odentia, these animals are small and insectivorous and are given their name due to their long snout resembling the trunk of an elephant. Afrosoricida contains the most species of this order, consisting of tenrix, golden moles, and otter shrews. While Afroinsectophilia mostly consists of insectivorous species today, there's evidence to suggest that it once contained species that were carnivorous, such as the diet-sized members of the order Ptolemaida. Originally grouped together with other mammalian carnivores...
Wait, Hyaenodon is one of these? You're kidding me. I thought Hyaenodon was like a Mesonicid or something. It's an Afrothere?
The Hyaenodont, they've most recently been placed in the Afroinsectophilia clade. Members of the clade
Paeongia... Wait, hang on. I gotta hear that again.
Ptolemaida, originally grouped together with other mammalian carnivores, such as the Hyaenodont.
Okay, no, Hyaenodonts are not Afrotheres. They're using this as a comparison here and saying they used to be grouped with Hyaenodonts, now they're not.
They've most recently been placed in the Afroinsectophilia clade.
Yeah.
Members of the clade Paeongulata, meaning almost hooves...
And there you go, Commodore, yes.
...grouped together with other ungulates, such as Perissodactyls. However, recent studies indicate
that... Oh, I love to see a dugong just going... just snuffling around on the seabed like that. I could watch this all day. Like, that's... What a cool animal. Anyway, Paeongulata. This is elephants and Sirenians. Right? Yeah. This is Proboscideans and Sirenians. Proboscideans are the elephants and their relatives. We've got a... lovely image there, actually. A gorgeous one. One that was so nice, I had to print it out and frame it. This is some beautiful work by paleo artist Mark Hallett. And if any of you were lucky enough to have zoo books as a kid, you might recognize this. There. Just exquisite work. Dynamic, memorable, eye-catching, superb. There are something like, I don't know, I think it's almost 200 different species of Proboscidean have been discovered so far. Proboscideans are elephants and their ancestors and relatives. And this is just a small sampling of them. We don't even have like the big shovel tuskers or the I don't know if we have like imperial mammoths here, do we? Or like Paleoloxodon. No, that is Paleoloxodon. Well, I'm not sure which species of Paleoloxodon it is, but yeah. Anyway, Commodore says I would get a poster of that. Isn't that awesome? Yeah. And this one is in Spanish. En español. Porque el inglés es más feo. Lo siento. Here's the best English version one I could find, which, you know, we've got page warping going on there. But yeah. Los ancestros de las elefantes. Yeah. Anyway, cool critters. I would get a poster of that too, Commodore. In fact, now I have one. A small one. Right here. And I kind of love that. You'll probably be seeing this in the future. I like that image so much. It's lovely. Yeah. And which of these lived alongside hominids, asked Misanthrope. We'll be getting to that in a little bit. But the imperial mammoth did, right here. The steppe mammoth, aka woolly mammoth. Or no, this is Mammuthis trogontheri. Huh. I don't know if they did. I know the woolly mammoth did, Mammuthis primigenius. The American mastodon, Mammut americana. Americanum. And a few of the rest of these. Channel Islands dwarf mammoth also lived alongside people. Well, it lived at the same time as people, but on the Channel Islands off the coast of California. And then people showed up, and then immediately these guys go extinct. probably hunted to extinction immediately by human interlopers. But yeah, yeah. Anyway, lovely tableau here. I love the composition, the dynamism. This piece actually helped inspire our paleontologizing logo. You know, this one right here, from like our starting soon screen. That's partly inspired by this piece, especially like the dust being kicked up in here to help like declutter this part of the composition. I love that, since you don't see like this tangle of legs back here, that would be very distracting. So they just, Mark Hallett just put a bunch of dust in here instead, and it helps tie the piece together. I like that a lot, you know? Yeah. Good stuff. Love this piece. Love this piece. It's excellent. Yeah. Misanthrope says, reminds me of the Zoo Tycoon cover art. Well, well, well. It kind of does, doesn't it? Yeah. Elephant. About to break through that entry gate there. Yeah. Yeah, I can see it. I can see it. Yeah, good stuff. Ah, I love it. I love it. And Sizzle says, does the P in elephant stand for pachyderm? And Sizzle, how are you doing? Welcome to paleontologizing. It's good to see you. The term pachyderm, no longer used. Pachyderm comes from a time when we thought that different groups of mammals were related to each other. It turns out that they're not. So pachyderm traditionally meant elephants, rhinoceros, hippos, and other like kind of big, gray, thick-skinned mammals like that. Turns out they are not related to each other. Hippos are actually closer to whales. They're like the sister group to whales. Elephants are the sister group to hyraxes and manatees. And rhinoceros are the sister group to tapirs and horses. So, pachyderm like that, that's a term that is now put. So yeah, Commodore says, how did we find out? DNA? That's part of it, Commodore, yeah. Yeah. In fact, I think this might have been during like the DNA cladistic revolution during like the 80s and stuff. Revolution, and being all melodramatic about it. During the implementation of new scientific methods during like the 1980s and 1990s, DNA sequencing and cladistic analyses, it became obvious that like, oh shoot, this group that like, before we've kind of lumped them together based on kind of arbitrary characteristics, turns out they are not the same as one another. Like, they're not part of a natural group. Yeah. Here, has anybody made a YouTube video about that? That would be incredible if that exists. Let's see. Nah, it doesn't look like it. Anyway, the video that we're watching right now about Afrotheria, this is the group that includes elephants. It includes elephants. It includes manatees and dugongs. It includes aardvarks and sengis, aka elephant shrews, tenrex and golden moles, otter shrews, and a few other critters like that. Yeah.
We group together with other ungulates such as perissodactyls. However, recent studies indicate that there's a larger gap on the mammalian tree of life between them than previously assumed. Payangulata branched off from the larger Afrotherian group.
Yeah, so there we go. Yeah, elephants, dugongs, manatees, hyraxes, tenrex, I think these are otter shrews, golden moles, sengis, aka elephant shrews, and then aardvarks over there are all part of Afrotheria. Yeah, yeah. Trappy Jenkins says, did someone take you clothes shopping, Danny? I've worn this shirt many times before, Trappy Jenkins. and I take my own self clothes shopping nowadays. Yeah, and I've actually got some new shirts arriving today. But yeah, yeah.
Hello.
The creature people are examining is a paleontologist.
Seaborn Show, thank you for the raid, and how are you doing? Welcome, welcome to paleontologizing. How are things? It is good to have you here. How did your stream go? Welcome, welcome back. It's good to have you here. Yeah. Looks like you were doing something called Stalker Call of Pripyat. Very cool, Seaborn Show. I hope all of your stalking was successful. And that you were successfully able to return Pripyat's call. Yeah. And Lordy says, can confirm Danny looks great. Thank you, Lordy. I appreciate that. That means a lot coming from you. Thank you. Yeah. Good stuff. Yeah. GTO Biker, how are you doing? Welcome, welcome to Paleontologizing. And happy National Elephant Day to you. Today we are celebrating these incredible animals. Answering machine mess. I'm sorry to hear that, Commodore. One of these days, Pripyat will pick up. It's National Elephant Day in Thailand, which means it's a wonderful excuse to talk about elephants here on Paleontologizing. Not just modern elephants, like this lovely Asian elephant here. Elephas maximus is the scientific name for the Asian elephant. We'll also be talking about mammoths and mastodons, gomphotheres, marithrium, paleoloxodon. Oh man, we're gonna get into the mammoths in just a minute. But yeah. Again, thank you, Seaborn Show, for the raid. I hope you had a great stream. My stalking always good, says Seaborn Show. Alright. And I love elephants too, SV Harkin. When I was a kid, my grandmother lived down the street, from this lady we called Grandma Doreen. Not related to us by blood, but she was just like a family friend. And she's like, kindly white-haired old lady, very gaunt, very nice. Her house full of elephants, not live elephants, but elephant trinkets, elephant plates, elephant blankets, elephant toys, just hundreds, maybe thousands of elephant tchotchkes throughout her house. And I always thought, even when I was a kid, when I was like 7 or 8, 9 years old, I thought, you know, someday Grandma Doreen should donate all of these to like an elephant museum, or like write that into her will or something. And I often wonder what happened to her elephant collection. Because it spanned the entire house, from big concrete elephant sculptures to little porcelain elephants about that big. Yeah, and Pontius Pirate says folks like that are easy to buy presents for, and I think that's kind of what happened. I don't even know if she liked elephants that much, but everyone would always just buy her elephant stuff. And, yeah, I even bought her some little elephant things at some point because I was just so enamored with this idea. Like, Grandma Doreen with the elephant house. Gotta buy her an elephant thing. And, yeah. Celtic Elephant says, everyone buys me elephant stuff. I'm always okay with it. Nice. I should ask my Nana. Nana Tyrannus, in fact. Whatever ever became of Grandma Doreen's elephant collection. Yeah. Trusasap says, do elephants have to eat constantly because they are so big? Elephants are pretty good at processing their food. They're pretty good at chewing, and so they don't have to eat the whole day long. Since they can almost kind of pre-digest their food by chewing, it's a pretty efficient system. If they have to feed on lower quality forage, like just grass and stuff, they do have to eat for more hours out of the day. But if they're able to gain access to fruit or alfalfa or something like that, like this lovely elephant on this reserve in Thailand is able to. I'm sure these elephants are very well treated. I mean, live music right there. That's pretty cool. I don't get this kind of treatment. I'm sure this elephant is able to enjoy most of the day just kind of his leisure time. Not to worry about eating 12 hours out of the day or anything. You know? Yeah. And that's interesting, SVR. And what do you think that means? Yeah. But yeah. Yeah. Good stuff. We're gonna transition from here now to an episode of Paleo World about some extinct elephants, mammoths. And if we're lucky, I haven't actually seen this episode, I don't think. It will even talk about the history of elephants in general, from their early evolution with critters like Erytherium and Marytherium, until critters that shared the earth with humans, like the woolly mammoth, the Colombian mammoth, American mastodon. There's a link to this video here. And I think these tusks have been cut to protect them from poachers, Pimpcat. Yeah. Aww. Lovely. Well, from there, let's jump into some ancient elephants here.
For millions of years, they dominated the land. Then, a two-legged predator invaded their world and changed it forever. Now these giants live only in our imagination. The majestic, mysterious mammoths.
I'm not sure, Commodore. Actually, you could look it up. This is an old series called Paleo World, which I watched when I was a kid, and this theme song still gets me right here. Just... oh my goodness. Dream this, watch this and dream of, you know, one day I'm going to be a paleontologist. One day I'm going to be making these discoveries. I'm going to be out in the field digging these fossils. And here we are.
The Black Hills of South Dakota pulse with life. Jackrabbits and coyotes, antelope and bison. But during the last ice age, 26,000 years ago, these hills rang out with the trumpeting of mighty creatures no longer of this earth, the mammoths. In their day, no other animal could match their size or majesty. Even the fiercest of predators stayed clear of these giants as they grazed the rolling grasslands. 11,000 years ago, the mammoths suddenly vanished, but not before a fluke of South Dakota geography preserved a vivid time capsule of their lives and deaths. In 1974, at a site called Hot Springs, a contractor began leveling the ground for a housing project. His equipment hit something unusual. Animal bones.
I've been here.
And a 7-foot-long tusk.
I did a live stream from here, chat, in summer of 2022. Yeah. Some of you were here for that. The Mammoth Site in Hot Springs, South Dakota. Pretty awesome place. It's pretty cool. It's pretty cool. That is a magical, magical spot. And you'll see why.
Paleontologist Larry Agenbrough,
remember that Celtic
elephant? Expert
nice.
On the prehistory of North America,
That's
was
invited
you
were there
to
too?
The
nice.
Site.
Isn't it such a cool place?
Impressed by the number of exposed bones, Agenbrough urged that construction be halted. He has been involved with Hot Springs ever since.
When I initially came to the site, we saw between 4 and 6 mammoths. That was exciting in itself. But now, 21 years later, we found our 51st mammoth last week.
Chomify, thank you for the follow and welcome to Paleontologizing. It's good to have you here. Yeah. Trusa Sap says, I assumed they became a woolly because of the ice ages. Sort of, yeah. Yeah. So, it's a little more complicated than that. But woolly mammoths were adapted for higher latitudes and kind of like colder environments. That's true. Yeah. Yeah. We'll talk about that in a bit. These, I think, are mostly Colombian mammoths. And Colombian mammoths, if I remember correctly, Colombian mammoths were actually thought to be a hybrid species, right? Between the imperial mammoth and the woolly mammoth? Yeah. There we go. Colombian mammoth. Mammuthus columbi. Yeah, so they've got longer tusks, and they're taller than your typical woolly mammoth. But not as tall as, like, an imperial mammoth. Yeah. Hybridization. A 2011 ancient DNA study of the complete mitochondrial genome, inherited through the female line, shows that 2 examined Colombian mammoths, including the morphologically typical Huntington mammoth, grouped within a subclade of woolly mammoths. This suggests that the 2 populations interbred and produced fertile offspring. So one possible explanation is the introgression of a haplogroup from woolly to Colombian mammoths, or vice versa. So we can see that in African elephants and African bush elephants today. Wait, where did I get that about imperial mammoths? In 2021, DNA older than 1 million years was sequenced for the first time from 2 step mammoth-like teeth, early Pleistocene age found in eastern Siberia. Interesting. Okay, so there is the suggestion that the North American Colombian mammoths had 40 to 50% ancestry from the Krestovska lineage and 50 to 60% related to woolly mammoths. Later, woolly and Colombian mammoths also interbred occasionally, and mammoth species perhaps hybridized routinely when brought together by glacial expansion. So there's a lot of interesting stuff going on genetically with these animals. Hybrid vigor for the win. Exactly, Wombat Hole. Yeah. 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 Mammuthus columbii and Mammuthus permission. Celtic elephant says, Danny, you're spot on. Excellent. Okay. Okay. Yeah. Saranlin says, you've done better than me, Danny. I watched Star Trek. and such science fiction shows. Well, here, I think we might even have a song for that. I watched Star Trek and such science fiction shows and thought, I want to grow up to build computers like that. All I discovered with those science fiction computers were horribly designed. Never meet your heroes, Saran Lin. Or never try to design the thing that was in the film or the TV show. Yeah. So it goes sometimes. So it goes. Yeah. Yeah. New gigantic Pleistocene turtle? I've not, Dr. Terra. What's this about? Huh. Is it a trionychid turtle, like a giant softshell turtle? Or is it like a tortoise turtle, like a Glossicelles or something? Yeah. Well, cool. Anyway, happy National Elephant Day to you, Dr. Terminator. L Cars is the best user experience ever, lol. I don't even know what that is, Otter doing. That sailed over my head. And Ooh, giant freshwater turtle. Oh, this probably is a trionychid, isn't it? That's a big honking turtle.
Reveals an extinct species of turtle closely related to the Amazon big-headed turtle.
Amazon big-headed turtle? What are those critters? Let's jump from Afrotheres to... Amazon big-headed turtle. And let's just search big-headed turtle or big space-headed turtle. Big-headed turtle. There we go. HD says, Amazon owns everything. Oh no. Platysternon? That means flat chest, I think? Megacephalum. Big head. You know, it delivers what it promises. It's got a flat chest and a big head. Big-headed turtle. They're unfortunately critically endangered. Yowza, yowza. Some here. There's one emerging from an egg. Very precocial. Let's get up and go. Oh. They do have a big head compared to their body. Now, with this new one, I wonder if they have a same size body as these guys and they just have a much larger head. That's a lower jaw you're saying there. Kidding, but let's continue.
Although quite similar in shape, the new species was almost 4 times larger than its living relative.
It looks bigger than that.
Freshwater turtles today do not exceed 1 meter and 40 centimeters. But the shell of Peltocephalus maturin may have reached around 2 meters. The new species lived in the Amazon region between 40,000 and 9,000 years ago, during the end of the Pleistocene.
The search for dinosaur bones begins in a place like this.
Nightshades_glow's search has succeeded with their 4 co-explorers.
Nightshades Glow, welcome to Paleontologizing. How are ya? Howdy, howdy, Nightshades Glow. You're doing something called Pokemon Fire Red / Leaf Green. Uh-oh, don't mix those up, especially if the leaves are dry. Welcome, welcome, Nightshades Glow. It's good to have you here. Happy National Elephant Day. We're taking a brief detour talking about turtles.
The arrival of humans in the region.
But pretty cool. This could be another species which, like most of the Proboscidean species that existed on Earth at the time that humans first showed up, have since been driven into extinction. And OdenSpear89, thank you for the raid. How are you doing? Welcome to Paleontologizing, OdenSpear. How did your stream go? Holy cow. Yeah. Thank you for the follow. I appreciate that.
Help me.
And Queen Freyax, thanks for your follow. Howdy, howdy. Welcome to Paleontologizing. Well, if any of you are here for the very first time, then let me introduce myself real quick. My name is Danny Anduza. I'm a dinosaur paleontologist. And I'm here on Twitch trying to do some good old-fashioned science outreach. I study dinosaurs. I dig up dinosaurs. I stream that fieldwork live during the summers. Looking forward to more dinosaur dig live streams this coming summer here on Twitch. In Wyoming and Utah. Maybe Idaho also. But anyway, when I'm not in the field, I'm streaming here from my office, and today is National Elephant Day. Indigo Thunder game of paleontology. And Serafina, thank you for the follows. Welcome to Paleontologizing. It is good to have you here. Excellent. Yeah. But yeah. Odin Spear says, I was streaming... Co-streaming with Nightshade's Glow, and he always recommends you? Well, excellent. Thank you, Nightshade's Glow.
The absolute prerequisite to the evolution of large mammals and to our own existence.
KT Croissant, thank you for the follow, and welcome, welcome to the channel. It's National Elephant Day today, so we are talking about elephants. We're talking about the evolution of elephants. We're talking about mammoths and mastodons and gomphotheres. We're talking about shovel tuskers and hoe tuskers and... dwarf mammoths and
this game of paleontology, much larger mysteries still remain.
And their ancestors too. M. Bergman 22, thank you for the follow. And Brightness.
You're not doing so badly yourself for a paleontologist.
Well, I appreciate the kind words there, M. Bergman, and I appreciate the follow. Welcome, welcome. It's good to have you here. Yeah. So yeah, yeah. Somebody was asking about... Oh, Commodore says, do you think...
Science is like a blabbermouth who ruins a movie by telling you how it ends. Well, I say there are some things we don't want to know. Important things.
Yeah! Spatty, thank you for the follow. Welcome, welcome to Paleontologizing. Commodore says, how long do you think critters in Chernobyl will mutate and be noticeably different apart from tumors and birth defects? I don't know if they will, Commodore, because... evolution like that, if you're going to evolve into a new species or a new morphology like that, you need to be genetically isolated from other critters, for the most part. And I don't know if that's happening in Chernobyl, you know? I think if anything, maybe there could be increased rates of mutation in Chernobyl. But if those critters that live there are able to interbreed with critters that live outside of the radiation zone, then you might see increased levels of... well, the traits that they develop might spread to outside of there as well. But it's not like we're going to have, you know, Blinky the three-eyed fish from The Simpsons, you know? It's like, that's not the kind of mutation that, like... usually spreads. This is like hopeful monsterism. It's a kind of an antiquated, outdated, debunked idea in evolution. Yeah. I don't know. Evolution's a bit more complicated than that. And I think more interesting in a lot of ways. But yeah. Yeah. And that's interesting, Trusa Sap. Where'd you get that? And yeah, Celtic Elephant, if anything, critters in Chernobyl have been doing really, really well because that's an exclusion area. And, like, people aren't allowed in, so animals can just thrive there. So, yeah. Yeah. But yeah, yeah. And there you go, Celtic elephant. Yep. Yes, indeed. Yeah. Anyway, let's get back to our mammoths here. There we go. Let's put that tab right there. And let's put that one right there. Oh, and this one here. Good stuff. All right. Mammoths.
Between 4 and 6 mammoths. That was exciting in itself. But now...
Bearded Fortress.
21 years...
Bearded Fortress, thank you so much for the 8 months. I really appreciate that. How are you doing? Thanks for keeping me online for the past 8 months. Good stuff. Appreciate you. Mammoths, let's get back into it.
We found our 51st mammoth last week. That is exciting, and the story's not over yet because it's at least 30 feet of mammoth-bearing material beneath where I'm standing.
This is the world's largest collection of Colombian mammoths, a species related to the woolly mammoths, but unique to North America.
Yep.
The Colombian mammoth, 14 feet high at the shoulder, more than twice my height, weighing up to 9 tons. That's like a big truck with a load on it. And no shaggy coat of hair. It was probably no more hairy than the average Asian or African elephant today.
Probably gray-colored. I don't know why they made that one brown, but that's okay.
Zone animal. It had big tusks, about the same size, but they were more robust because it used these tusks to dig holes and maybe take branches off trees and so on.
All the Colombian mammoths found at Hot Springs also share another unique characteristic.
And there's a whole bunch of these here, which is really cool. But Colombian mammoths, to give you a better idea of what they would have looked like, you know, they would have looked something like this. Yeah, long tusks sometimes. Ridiculously long tusks. These were pretty cool animals. Yeah. And they are indeed a kind of elephant. There's a woolly mammoth next to a Colombian mammoth. So Colombian mammoths, noticeably larger. Those front legs are long. They are indeed, Trissa Sapp. Yes. Yes, indeed. That gives you a good impression of how big these animals are. Or were. Still are. Their bones still are that big. And that's a really neat... I like that depiction of them next to some bison and some pronghorn. That's lovely. These are like a quintessential North American animal. North American plains animal. And they're extinct now. They may have been hunted to extinction by the first humans to, by some of the first humans to show up in North America. And these guys lived all over the place. You know, from Florida to California, from New York to Washington State, up into Canada, down into Mexico. They ranged all across North America. And chances are, wherever you... If you are in North America right now, chances are there is a Colombian mammoth that has been found near where you are currently sitting or standing or walking or whatever. Here in the San Francisco Bay Area. We've got... a bunch. From not too far from where I'm sitting right now. Here in the... and the lovely, beautiful, sunny San Francisco Bay Area. A ton of Colombian mammoths from around. Mostly isolated bits. We don't have, like, a beautiful graveyard of them, like in Hot Springs, South Dakota, but we've got plenty of individual mammoths scattered throughout the San Francisco Bay Area. And I can show you that right here. Let's see. Let's do genus. Mammuthus, and let's do just Alameda County, California, where I am right now. So each one of these is a different mammoth specimen. I think these are all Mammuthus columbiae. Yeah, Colombian mammoths. All from right here, just in my county. There's a lot. There's a lot. This one's got a picture. Right there. Big old tooth of a Colombian mammoth. Look at that. Lovely. Yeah, this is from Fremont, California. We've got another tooth right there. And this is also from Fremont, California. This one was found at Berkeley Municipal Wharf. We don't have a photo of this one, but they're all over the place around here. I even made a t-shirt to that effect. I'll show you. I almost wore that for today's stream. But yeah. Just down the road from me, in Oakland, California, we have Colombian mammoths, and, there we go. This is a t-shirt design that I created, and then I hand-printed this after burning a silk screen. I was actually, when I first moved back to California, I was, gonna try and make a living designing and printing and selling t-shirts like I used to in Montana. And I found better ways of making a living. But this is one of the designs that I came up with early on. So yeah. And that's SF BART. That's the Bay Area Rapid Transit, our commuter train there. At downtown Oakland, you've got those container cranes at the Port of Oakland. You've got the Oakland Federal Buildings. You've got the Oakland Tribune clock tower there. Yeah. Yeah. It beats international. We no longer have nuclear vessels in the Alameda. That naval base has been shut down. So yeah. Yeah. Anyway. Colombian mammoths all over the place here in North America. That one there in particular was meant to represent the one from the Oakland Coliseum. If any of you are fans of what the Japanese call Beisboru, quintessential Japanese sport that we in the United States sometimes also partake in, I believe we here it's called, it's been translated to baseball. There's a team called the Oakland A's, which also have an elephant as their mascot. And I don't know if this is actually a reference to the mammoth that was dug up. At the stadium. So, Oakland Coliseum. Yeah, that stadium right there. The Oakland A's Stadium. While they were excavating the foundation for this, they found a mammoth tusk. And a mammoth tooth fragment. A mammoth tooth fragment again. A femur fragment. A humerus fragment. Right there, humerus frag. And last one. Oh, never mind. Unrelated. But yeah. Yeah. But yeah. Yeah. white elephant, the team's unofficial mascot. Oh, so I guess that's unrelated to the fossil elephant that was found there, the fossil mammoth. But yeah, yeah. Anyway. And Celtic Elephant says, I didn't know there was an elephant baseball team. Too bad I'm a Yankees fan already. I don't know. I'm uncommitted when it comes to sports teams. Whatever. They've never done anything for me. Why should I care? Might as well pick it just based on the mascot. Yeah. I don't know. I really like playing sports. I get bored to tears watching sports. Oh, man. It's like taking a dog to the park and then making the dog sit in a crate and just watch all the other dogs play. It's like, no, you can't play. You have to watch. That's what I feel like watching sports, you know? Yeah. Anyhow, Misanthrope says, were Colombian mammoths pale? We don't know. We don't actually know what color they were. Yeah. And Dramignophyte, thank you, Claire Burr, for reposting that. Important message. Dramignophyte says, I finally got to meet with the curator of a major mineral museum. They're really excited about the crystal and fluorite fossils. I donated about 8 items, and 7 will most likely be displayed. Holy cow! But one of them, I told them I would only donate it if they promised it would be on display 100%. They said yes instantly, and even brought me to see exactly where it's going. Holy cow, Dramignophyte! I'm really looking forward to seeing photos of this in the Discord if you want to post sometime soon. That's super exciting. Holy moly. A specimen that you found on display at your local museum. That is a good feeling. That's gotta be a good feeling. Holy cow. I know anytime I found fossils that end up on display, there's just a surge of pride there. It's like, yes, I got to contribute to something.
I'm here to applaud the larger work than just of vertebrate myself. Paleontologists.
And Victoraptor, thank you for the follow. Sounds like you might be in the right place, Victoraptor. Welcome, welcome to Paleontologize. It's good to have you. Yeah. So yeah, yeah. See if I can dig it up. Yeah, Dreaming the Fight. See if you can find that link, and then we'll take a look at it. Yeah. Wombat Hole says, is it true that elephants can't jump? To my knowledge, that is true. Yeah. They can rear up on their hind limbs, but they don't really... They've got pretty stout limbs. They don't have too much, like, bounce in their step. I don't think elephants can jump. So I think that is true. Repost to save time? Sounds good, Dramignophyte. Yeah. Yeah. And what does Sam have to say about paleontologists, Dame Karen? Well, I'll show you. Let me see if I can find that video. That's Sam Waterston, right? There we go. This is like a video editor put this together for like his portfolio.
Hello, I'm Sam Waterston, and I'm here to applaud the work of vertebrate paleontologists as they reveal the evidence for environmental change, adaptation, and extinction. This is a rare opportunity to view the inside story of the extraordinary world of paleontologists.
Oh, please, make me blush.
Why what they do is important for science and society. That is to say, what their work means for us.
Yeah, and here's a link, you know, if you want to watch the rest of it. But yeah, yeah. Good stuff. And elephants can't jump, but they do walk on their toes. Yeah, elephants have a digitigrade stance, so they walk on their toes, even though their ancestors walked on their... They didn't walk on their toes. So yeah, yeah. Thought elephants were plantigrade? Their ancestors were, Salamander, but elephants today are digitigrade. Yeah. Here, I think we have a video about that. A video that talks about that, right? Yeah, here, let's take a look at this. Sure.
It's you.
Whoop! Holy cow! BC23D! Well, hello, hello! Welcome to Paleontologizer.
BC_2_3D and their 14 raiders are about to get flattened by dinosaur content.
Yes, indeed. Welcome, BC23D, to Paleontologizing. How did your stream go? How are you? Welcome, welcome. If anybody's here for the very first time, allow me to introduce myself really quick. My name is Danny Anduza. I'm a dinosaur paleontologist. Today we're talking about elephants, but that's another story. As a paleontologist, I dig up fossils. I study fossils. I publish on fossils in the scientific literature. I talk about fossils 5 days a week here on Twitch. I specialize in dinosaurs, but sometimes we branch out to talk about our proboscidian friends. Like on today, National Elephant Day. National Elephant Day in Thailand. But that's okay. We're still celebrating it. Did the heavy hair. And Creatrix Brit, how are you doing? Howdy, howdy. Yeah. BC23D says hello, and hello right back at you, BC. I hope you had a wonderful stream. You were doing something called Just Chatting. Lovely. I hope it was joyous. I'm glad you're here now. Welcome, welcome. Yeah. We are, of course, celebrating National Elephant Day today. And so, let's get back into it, shall we? Here we go. Yep.
And weigh up to 18,000 pounds.
Yep. What, 14 feet tall? 13 feet tall. Holy cow, yeah. What was that again? Come on, YouTube. When I think of an elephant's legs, slender is not the word that comes to mind there. If anything, it's like their legs are too thick and not built to be springy. You know, I don't know about that. Yep. They are digitigrade. This is pretty darn cool right here. So this is like the standard kind of a test that you do to see if an animal has a degree of like self-awareness. Is you do the mirror test. You put a mark on the critter and then you sit it in front of a mirror and say, look at that. And if they look in the mirror and then they don't care about the mark on their head, then it's like they don't recognize that they're seeing themselves in the mirror. But if they do recognize the mark on their heads or wherever else on their body where you put it, and they like try and brush it off, only looking in the mirror, then it shows that they recognize that they are seeing their own reflection. It's like a really simple kind of test to see if a critter's got self-awareness like that. You know? Yeah. Yeah. And the test has been performed on birds, and multiple species of bird have passed it. Yes, indeed, salamander, yeah.
Their ability to recognize themselves in a mirror.
Other groups of birds have since been found to do this as well. And other groups of mammals, too. I think certain dogs have passed this. And certain fishes have, too. Actinopterygian, rayfin fishes also have. I think, what kind of fish was it? I forget. But yeah, and I think pigs have, too, Celtic elephant. Yeah, yeah. Yeah. Yep. Scritchy derm, scritchy skin. Holy cow. Oh. Yep. Dentin. I've got the enamel, the pulp cavity in there, and it essentially is just a modified incisor, like your two front teeth right here. Really cool stuff. Really cool. Yeah. Pretty cool. Oh. People have killed elephants. Demand has caused elephant populations to decline. Enough with the passive language, you know? It's not demand that caused elephant populations to decline. It's people murdering elephants that caused elephants to become murdered. Yeah, and Trusisap says rhino horn is actually more like hair or nails and not ivory, right? That's true, Trusisap. Yeah, so a rhino horn is keratin. So that's the same material as your finger or toenails or your hair. Keratin. Elephant tusks are actually like tooth material. So like rhino ivory is keratin. Totally different from like the dentine and enamel that's in an elephant's tusk. That's correct there. Yeah. Yeah. Oh, and very cool, Germagnophyte. Very cool. We'll take a look at that in a minute. Remind me. Yeah.
African elephants are listed as...
I think this depends on which country and which species of African elephant. Because there are two species. There's the African bush elephant and the African forest elephant. I think forest elephants are endangered. Well, you know what? Let's look it up. African forest elephants. Here we go. Critically endangered. Yowza. Look at that red right there. Critically endangered. Oh, African elephants aren't endangered. No, they definitely are. African forest elephants, at least. Yeah, African bush elephants. Also endangered. I don't know what National Geographic was saying there, but they were wrong. They were what?
They were wrong. They were wrong. They were wrong.
Yeah, that was when they counted both species as one. Yeah. Yeah. When was the video made? Let's take a look at that, actually. Let's take a look at that. 6 years ago, so that would have been, what, 2018? Something like that? I think... Yep, see? 6 years ago. I'm pretty sure that splitting up the species, bush elephants and forest elephants, I'm pretty sure that happened before 2018. Yeah. Phylogeny and evolution. Wish it would give us a timeline on this. This is from the year 2000. This publication is from 2001, 2007, 2010, and 2011. So yeah, that video is out of date when they made it, it seems. When was it that National Geographic was sold to Fox Broadcasting or whatever? Fox Media? March 2019, it was purchased by Disney. Which now owns 20th Century Fox, doesn't it? Yeah. In September 2015, the National Geographic Society moved the magazine to a new owner, National Geographic Partners, giving 21st Century Fox a 73% controlling interest. Yeah. I'm not saying that you can directly state that corresponds to the drop-off in quality, but... Anyway. Yeah.
...have decreased immensely.
Oh, yeah.
The species' habitat once stretched across Asia, from Syria to northern China.
And I think a lot of people would be surprised to hear this, but yeah, absolutely. They once went all the way across the continent of Asia. They had one of the widest distributions of, like, any terrestrial mammal larger than a dog, you know? Yeah. Not anymore. Holy cow. Yeah. Yeah.
But today, they only exist in isolated pockets between India and Indonesia.
Yowza. My mouse article. Beats what? Mickey Mouse. Anyway, very cool. Let's get back to Paleo World here with our mammoths.
and filled with water from a natural spring.
Backwards.
This sinkhole might have looked like an ordinary pond.
Salamander says, is it true that small localities experience greater populations than that amount of land can support? Population fragmentation has been severe and severely detrimental to elephant population because they like to say it creates human-animal conflict. I mean, when you, anytime you box in a large animal like that that likes to migrate great distances, yeah, that's not going to be good for them, for sure. And that will mean that they, like, strip the vegetation bare in certain areas, and that will create conflicts because then they go looking for food in places that farmers have set up shop and started growing crops. So, I don't know. Animals, like, for me, one of the really interesting things is, like, when we look at this, we look at the former range of Asian elephants across the continent here, across Asia. This is one continuous species, as far as we can tell. Contiguous across the entire continent. Elephas maximus. One species. From eastern China all the way to Syria. One species. Which tells us that, like, these animals are able to travel great distances in order to stay one species. They're trading genes across this entire range in order to stay one species. And not develop into different species like this. To not allopatrically speciate. That means these are highly, highly mobile animals. If they're able to trade genes from Syria all the way to eastern China like this, you know? Like, these are animals that are just moving around all over the place. Highly, highly mobile creatures. This is actually, Salamander, this, maybe Denver talks about this too, but this is kind of how I envision big dinosaurs during the Cretaceous in North America. It's just, they're just moving from one side of the continent to the other. You know, all this stuff about endemism, I'm not necessarily convinced about. I think like elephants, dinosaurs also would have been highly mobile. Ceratopsians and hadrosaurs and tyrannosaurs. And Kick KJ, thank you for the follow. Welcome to Paleontologizing. It's good to have you here. Oh, an interesting Charlie's Dragon. Elephants stay away from bees? That's cool. Trusa Sap says, I guess if elephants decide to come eat your farm, there's not much you can do about it. Salamander says, just imagine the environmental impact those dinosaurs were capable of, just based on how efficiently elephants can change their ecosystem. Yeah. Like an elephant knocking down a tree, you can imagine a ceratopsian dinosaur doing much the same thing. Not just knocking it down, but also maybe just biting the tree in half with its jaws. It reminds me of, I think William Stout had an illustration in one of his books. Where did I put that? Where is my William Stout's The Dinosaurs? There it is. Yeah, here. Webcam. Now it's working. Okay, good. Lovely Megalosaurus there. But William Stout had a lovely illustration in this book that kind of calls forth that idea. I think it was a Styracosaurus. Just going to town on a plant there. Big cycad or something. But it kind of reminded me of that notion of, like, really modifying your own surroundings to suit your needs. There it is. Lovely illustration there.
Just beautiful. The Styracosaurus just going to town on that that cycad after having knocked it over. The same way that elephants will knock down a tree to get to the leaves sometimes. Yeah. Look at that. Yeah. Yeah. And very funny beats international. anyway, let's get back to get back to our mammoths here.
But it was 70 feet deep.
There we go.
Around 26,000 years ago, an underground cavern collapsed and filled with water from a natural spring. This sinkhole might have looked like an ordinary pond, but it was 70 feet deep, with treacherously steep and slippery walls.
There you go, that's your fire.
In time, lush grasses would obscure these dangers and lure mammoths to their deaths.
I'm going to get lured to the bathroom right now. Pool.
Others perhaps slipped at water's edge.
I will be right back. In either case,
it was a one-way trip.
Hopefully this same fate does not befall me. Cross your fingers, I don't fall in. I'll be right back, okay?
Unable to scale the slippery walls, the huge beasts drowned or starved to death. Eventually, the hot spring sinkhole dried up as its walls broke down and sediment slowly filled the pit. Layers of deposits up to 3 feet deep separate the skeletons not just in space, but in time, allowing Agenbrod to calculate a rough chronology of the site.
So we're looking at maybe as many as 100 mammoths that died over a period of up to 700, 750 years, maybe one a decade, or maybe two if somebody tries to pull their friend out and falls in too.
The story of Hot Springs seemed rather straightforward until the bones revealed one last fact. Nearly every one of the sinkhole victims was a young male in his prime. Fossils alone can't explain this bias. But 6,000 miles and a continent away, a living giant may help scientists solve this mystery. Mammoths no longer walk the earth, but some of their relatives do. The striking resemblance between elephants and mammoths stems from close family ties.
I didn't fall in.
For paleontologist Gary Haynes at the University of Nevada, elephant bones provide key anatomical benchmarks. The size and maturity of teeth are a function of age.
I'm not familiar with that salamander.
Gender can be determined by the shape of the pelvic bones.
It's not gender. We're talking about mammoths here. It's sex. But I understand they're probably not going to say sex in a show like this. Might get flagged by the censors. But gender is a human thing, you know? This is different.
Haynes applies these indicators to mammoth fossils. In this way, he can gather vital statistics about an animal that died thousands of years ago.
And I know Celtic elephant.
But these details alone can't bring the ancient bones back to life.
We have nothing to study of mammoths except bones and teeth, but we can actually go a long way towards understanding their behavior by looking at a very close relative, the African elephant and the Asian elephant. We can study their social behavior, social structure, and understand, I think, a lot about how mammoths must have lived and died.
And Patrick Crusader, hopefully we can talk about that in a little bit. Apparently they're very close to reviving the mammoths. We're not actually that close. It would still be decades and decades away, and it wouldn't be reviving. It would be basically creating like a facsimile of a mammoth through genetic manipulation of Asian elephants. But we'll talk about that in a bit. I think, we might even cut this video short so that we can get to that before we raid into Balint. and science streams. But I'm all for that if it means also protecting endangered elephants as well, which it should. There is more than enough money in the world for that kind of thing to both, you know, create a convincing facsimile of a woolly mammoth and also save their current closest living relative, the Asian elephant, from extinction. We could do both. In fact, if reviving the mammoth helps in conservation of Asian elephants, then I am totally all for it. But a lot of this just kind of gets into, like, what are our priorities as human beings? Do we want to continue as we have been, spewing carbon emissions into the atmosphere, warming our planet, deforesting, clearing rainforest to make room for cattle for more McDonald's burgers? Or do we want to actually make things better, you know? Reviving mammoths, I see, as part of the making things better option. Anyway, we'll get into that more in a little bit. And yeah, we also have Metazoa too. We might do that tomorrow, Claire. We might do today's tomorrow. But yeah. And Celtic Elephant, yeah, that's exactly what I'm talking about. The Colossal with George Church and that team. We'll be talking more about that in a bit. Yeah, Richard Roadshow says, do we want to keep trying to master our environment, a.k.a. destroy it? Or do we want to finally want to cooperate with it? Exactly, Retro Roadshow, yeah.
Mammoths and elephants share a common ancestor that arose in Africa.
There we go.
Around 5 million years ago, their bloodlines diverged. This common heritage means elephants can provide a living mirror of their long-lost cousins.
Yep.
Like elephants, Colombian mammoths were herbivores and probably spent most of their time foraging for vegetation. Their huge bulk would have needed some 770 pounds of food every day, a staggering 152,000 calories, washed down by over 40 gallons of water. Mammoth society was probably matriarchal, based on groups of 10 or more related females and their offspring. Young females would remain within their group. But as young males reached sexual maturity, around 10 years of age, they began to set out on their own to explore the environment.
Yep, and it's those bachelor males running around getting in trouble.
These adolescent males were adventurous, but inexperienced. Yeah. They would have been easy victims for a deadly trap like the sinkhole at Hot Springs. Only an immature male would have rushed so recklessly toward the sparkling water.
Mixed herds where there's females and young would probably prevent their young from going down into these things, but young males living on their own don't have the animals interfering with them, and they probably would do this over and over again. Each animal would find itself entrapped, unable to get out.
Experience and maternal instinct saved most mammoths from the hazard that was Hot Springs, South Dakota, over 26,000 years ago. The site's preponderance of young male victims now makes tragic sense.
Yep.
But a far greater tragedy remains unsolved. The Colombian mammoth is extinct. This simple fact fuels a lifelong passion in Larry Agenbrod.
We don't have evidence of that Celtic elephant. We don't. Yeah.
This is a mammoth that's unique to North America, and this is where we begin to find out some of the answers to the mysteries of how this animal lived and died, and maybe even why it became extinct.
Agenbrod aims to find out why the mammoth suddenly vanished around 11,000 years ago. His quest will take him to an unlikely place.
A Catalina Island?
Desolate island where the forces of evolution took an intriguing twist.
Yeah, very cool stuff. And from there... Regbok, thank you for the follow, and welcome to Paleontologizer. Here, I'll give you a link if you want to watch the rest of this Paleo World episode here. But let's take a look at... Well, we've already talked about the Channel Island mammoths. Let's take a look at a brief video here instead of this long PBS Yonder. Here, take a look at this. So this is from the Channel Islands off the coast of California. So, California. Right here is, that's kind of a crude representation of the beautiful sunny San Francisco Bay Area there. Golden Gate Bridge that you see right here where I live, is right here, linking San Francisco and the Marin Peninsula right there. Down south, off the coast of Santa Barbara down here, you have the Channel Islands right here. These are these big offshore islands that used to be connected to the mainland. Basically, this light blue that you see here used to be the coast during the last ice age. Like, this used to be dry land along here. Sea levels rose. Now this is underwater. What used to be hills became islands off the coast. And some really interesting things happened there.
About 30,000 years ago, right here where you are standing, huge Colombian mammoths roamed.
Yep.
They were as tall as 14 feet high and weighed up to 20,000 pounds.
Way before Mexico, Teresa Sapp.
This low, flat coastal plain was clothed in parkland vegetation, a rich mosaic of grasses, herbaceous plants, shrubs, and trees. Mammoths of this size needed lots of food and water, spending most of every day ranging far distances to fuel their great bulk. They relied on their exceptional sense of smell to find food.
Yep. They don't have great eyes. They don't have the best eyes.
Mammoths could catch only occasional whiffs of vegetation, since it was already heavily grazed by themselves and by other animals. However, turning toward the ocean, the hungry mammoths could smell something quite different.
Yeah.
Here, the consistent onshore winds carried the aroma of abundant grasses and shrubs from the huge mountainous island of Santa Rosa.
Yeah. Which no longer exists like this, as we'll get to. But this used to be a huge offshore island. I think before this, it was actually part of the mainland, right? I don't think it was always. Maybe it was. I don't know. Not always, but during the time of that mammoths were walking around, maybe it didn't used to be part of the mainland. But this became several islands later when sea levels rose and inundated these low-lying areas.
So alluringly close to them, a mere 4 to 5 miles across the sea. It was an easy decision and an easy swim to the island. No land-dwelling mammals are better suited to water than members of the elephant family, with their long snorkel-like trunks and their buoyant mass that can shed the effects of their ponderous pounds. They move so gracefully in the ocean. Once on the island...
They really do. Elephants are actually really, really good at swimming. You might see this and go, what? But... they're very good swimmers. Very, very good swimmers. Here, take a look. That's an Asian elephant again. floating out into the water there. And they love to swim. Holy cow, that's got to be an amazing feeling as an elephant. Usually you're pretty heavy walking around and then suddenly you're weightless. You know? Yeah. Pretty cool. I've not been able to find a really good video of swimming elephants here. Let's try this one, maybe? Yeah, there we go. Swimming in open water past a jellyfish there, a sea jelly. Yeah. Pretty neat. It's crazy how they swim like that. I mean, it makes a lot of sense. They've got a built-in snorkel. They've got powerful limbs for paddling. And, you know, they've got lungs full of air. It helps them stay afloat. Yeah. Pretty cool. Pretty cool. Yeah.
Ponderous bounds. They move so gracefully in the ocean. Once on the island, the population of mammoths increased in numbers, and eventually, the food supply became scarce there, too. And over time, the thick glaciers and ice sheets that covered Canada and Northern Asia began to melt. The level of the sea gradually rose, stranding the mammoths and flooding the lowlands of the island. The island decreased in size and eventually was split into four separate islands, the ones we know today. With this decrease in island size, the food supply was ever more limited, especially in times of seasonal shortage. The smaller mammoths that could survive with less food were at an advantage. The absence of predators on the islands also contributed to the downsizing, since large size was no longer needed for predator avoidance and defense.
Yep.
Thus, natural selection favored smaller mammoths. Within 20,000 years, most stood only 5 to 6 feet at the shoulder, less than half the height of their mainland ancestors. These small mammoths became a new species, the Channel Islands Pygmy Mammoth.
Yeah, insularization, exactly.
The bones that lie before you are the remains of one of these pygmy mammoths. It roamed the islands, feeding on prehistoric grasses, sharing the space with flightless geese and tiny island foxes. Then, about 12,800 years ago, along the northern coast of what we now call Santa Rosa Island, this 50-year-old arthritic male came to the end of his journey.
Aww.
He lay down on his left side and died. The island winds
Step
quickly
right
buried
there.
His body with sand, his skin still intact.
Step two.
The demise of the rest of the pygmy mammoths would follow. In fact, most of the world's large mammals disappeared from Earth about 10,000 years ago. Mm-hmm. What caused the extinction of all these large animals is still uncertain. In 1994, a clue to this mysterious past was discovered. Over time, erosion exposed this ancient animal to the eyes of the modern world. 12,000 years after the pygmy's death, its fully articulated skeleton, whose replica bones lie before you, was discovered and excavated, revealing the world's most complete pygmy mammoth skeleton ever found. You can now discover the pygmy mammoth's past on your own as you explore this interactive CD-ROM.
Yeah,
learn
or this YouTube video.
Intriguing stories of mammoth origins.
Ah!
How they lived.
Our
why they became extinct. The discovery of mammoth fossils. The history of humans and mammoths. And the importance of the Channel Islands and ongoing preservation efforts there. You may even find out the answer to the long-debated question. Why did the mammoth cross the channel? So, click on an icon and take your own journey of discovery.
Yeah, 90s interactive CD-ROMs are the best. Agreed, Retro Roadshow. Agreed. Here. There's a link to that video right there. And, yeah, Paleoloxodon falconeri. Is that the one from Cyprus? But,
In 1873, a geologist named Robert Stearns reported a rather odd find on the Channel Islands off the coast of Southern California. He had discovered a single tooth from an animal that wasn't known to have lived on the islands, a mammoth. The tooth was a bit on the small side, but it was obviously from a mammoth, and it was enough for Stearns to conclude that the Channel Islands must have once been connected to the mainland. Otherwise, he thought, how could a mammoth have gotten there? Well, Stearns' hypothesis turned out to be wrong. The islands weren't ever part of the mainland.
Oh, they weren't ever part of the mainland. Okay.
The tooth would eventually be recognized as evidence for something even more unexpected. By 1928, enough mammoth fossils had been found on the Channel Islands that paleontologists realized that many of them were unusual. Usually small, around 2 meters tall at the shoulder. The mammoths were so small that they came to be seen as their own species, commonly known as the Channel Islands pygmy mammoths. These animals aren't known anywhere else in the world, which means that they must have evolved in place on the Channel Islands. But
and she's right about that. Oh, and by the way, this Charles R. Knight painting there of the Columbian mammoth. Well, 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 where else do we see that? I wonder. We've got a lovely assortment of different. We've got a very, very heavy Charles R. Knight influence today. Right there. And right there, this mastodon is actually a sculpt by Charles R. Knight that I've 3D printed. This mammoth, also a Charles R. Knight sculpt. This mastodon and this mastodon, all Charles R. Knight pieces. And then of course we've got Mark Hallett and William Stout as well. Oh, and those were from Sicily. Nice. Yeah, what she was saying here about these animals aren't known anywhere else in the world, this is true. This particular species of dwarf mammoth only from the Channel Islands. But there are other species of dwarf mammoth and dwarf elephant, dwarf mastodon, etc., from other parts of the world, usually from islands, which is also really cool. Yeah. Anyway, I'll give you a link to this video, but I'm kind of wondering. Oh, we're very sure they weren't just juveniles. Yeah, Trusasap, yeah. Yeah. But yeah, yeah. I'm wondering, should we continue with our mammoth discussion here? Or should we jump into Science Streams' stream? And Reaganation, we do think that there were several varieties of dwarf dinosaurs on islands in Europe in the late Cretaceous. But some of those did just turn out to be juveniles also. So, yeah. yeah. I think another time we'll talk about mammoth resurrection and all of that. Yeah. Oh, and thank you, Dripping to Fight. Let's take a look at those two. What channel, which part of the Discord did you put them in? Was it the fossils category? Let's see. It's been a week since I've been on Discord. Yeah. Fossil picks, perhaps. Oh, very cool, Germagnifite. Very cool. Oh, and very nice thing, in honor of International Elephant Day, mammoth molars from Siberia. Very cool. Very cool. Yeah. Ringnophyte has got... Very interesting. Interesting permineralization of these. This looks like a fossil coral. Is that what it is then?
We are leading him into a trap where we can destroy him with our deadly laser.
Very cool. Really neat, Dramagnify. The one that you made them promise to display. It's a crystallized coral. Oh, very cool. Very, very cool. Take a look at that. Wow. look at the glinting there. Crystals within it. Very neat. That's super cool, Jermaine, to fight. That's super, super cool. I'm so glad that that they took you up on that. Oh, man, this is neat. Yeah. Look at that. Reminds me of, like, the inside of a geode. Look at that. Yeah. And they fluoresce, too? Or what's going on here? Oh, very cool. And it is a geode, yeah, I guess it is. Yeah. Really neat. This, again, looks like the inside of a fossil coral. Really neat. Really neat, Dramignified. Thank you for sharing. I'm so glad that those are going to be in the museum. If you'd like, you can share which museum that is if people would like to go see it. But I understand you don't want to dox yourself or anything, so whatever you're comfortable with, I respect that. Thank you for sharing. Yeah. Yeah. The A.E. Seaman's Museum. Very cool. The A.E. Seaman Mineral Museum. Oh, this is cool. Mineral Museum of Michigan. Very nice. Where is this located? Because I spent some time in northern Michigan, not the Upper Peninsula, but in around like Michigan's west coast, up near like Frankfort, Ludington, areas like that. Yeah. And this is in. Oh, it's in the UP.
Cousin Marvin Berry, you know that new sound you're looking for? Well, listen to this.
Lisa the Succubrat, thank you for the raid, and how are you doing? Welcome, welcome.
Has a new sound for their four listeners.
Welcome to Paleontologizing. How are you? I hope you had a good stream. It's good to have you here. Yeah. Happy National Elephant Day to you, Lisa. Glad you're here. And again, I hope you had a really good stream. You're playing something called Helldivers 2. Well, well, well. I hope it was fun. I hope you enjoyed. Yeah. Good stuff. Good stuff. Yeah, I've never been to the UP. Oh, yeah, there. Say ya to the UP there, eh? I've never been to the Upper Peninsula of Michigan. But, first time I go, I should go see that museum. Very cool. Cool stuff, Dramignified. Cool stuff. Yeah. But yeah. And that's nice. That makes sense. We're spectacular in person, I assume. But yeah. Yeah. Anyway.
Around 12.
I'm kind of tempted to take a look at this video here. Can we bring back the? Oh, we can bring back the woolly mammoths, should we? I'm not convinced we can.
Dinosaur.
Chestnut Place, thank you for the follow and welcome to Paleontologizing. Good to have you here. Yeah. I I figure if we pull this video up, that'll probably be another half an hour to an hour of time here. And you know what? I'm gonna start to get hungry before that. I'm thinking maybe we should just jump over to Cyant Streams. And your OBS scenes are so nice. Thank you, Lisa. I appreciate that. I really do. I think that'll be a discussion for another time. I think when there's another major breakthrough, which there probably will be one soon, I'm guessing. It'll probably hit the news at some point in the near future. We will have another chance to talk about this soon. The Woolly Mammoth will be back in 6 years. Oh boy. Don't tease me like that, Colossal. Yeah. I could only hope. But yeah, Woolly Mammoth de-extinction process. There's too much to talk about here. It's gonna take us too long. Happy National Elephant Day to you too. Karmacy Jedi Hero 1025. Howdy, howdy. Welcome. Maybe in preparation for when we do talk about this, there is a lovely article from The Atlantic, of all places. Welcome to Pleistocene Park. In Arctic Siberia, Russian scientists are trying to stave off catastrophic climate change by resurrecting an ice age biome complete with lab-grown woolly mammoths. One of the coolest things about this article is that you can actually listen to it. And wait, this used to be free. Anyway, maybe if you go into the Wayback Machine or something, you can get this. But it's actually a really well-read article, apart from being very well-written. I swear, like a year or two ago, this was totally free. I've recommended it before. But yeah. The mammoth is always 6 years away, says Commodore 256. When was it that was written? Woolly Mammoth will be back in 6 years. They've probably very conveniently neglected to put a date on this. But I wonder how many years ago this was that they said this. This one should have a byline and a... Oh, 2021. Okay, so this was 3 years ago. Or 2.5 years ago. So, okay. You've got 3.5 years left there, Colossal. I hope you can do it. Steely Dan says, mad respect for not wanting to get into a discussion unless Danny can fully address it properly. That's the mark of quality and integrity right there. Thank you, Steely Dan. Hey, thank you kindly for that. Seriously. That means a lot to me. I'm always eager to jump into things and talk about them, but I gotta consider my own limits and really treat these subjects with the respect and attention that they deserve, and I don't feel like I can do that right now. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna wrap up today's stream. But don't go away just yet. Do not go away just yet, because I'm not stopping streaming. I'm just ending our broadcast on this channel. I'm going to be jumping into Cyant Streams' channel with molecular and systems biologist Blint. And we are going to be talking about some new scientific papers. And yes, I will be on screen, on camera, everything else. So don't go away. What we're going to do here is commence our wrap-up. And there's another lovely Pleistocene mammal there. Not a woolly mammoth, but Smilodon. Smilodon calcaniformis. Or Smilodon fatalis, whatever they call it now. Thank you to everybody who's being named in our credits at present. And there's Blint. Blint looks like he is ready for us to jump in there, so we're going to do that very shortly. Let's let these credits run by. Oh, and let's start the raid, too. Raid science streams. Good stuff. Like I said, don't go away, everybody. We're going to go jump into science streams. And we're going to be talking about a new genus and species of fossil bird. The same one that we were talking about yesterday. I'm going to get Balint's take on this. We're going to talk about the evolution of birds and how birds lost their teeth throughout the Cretaceous. And we're also going to be talking about the intelligence of social insects like bees and how they can learn from one another. How this was actually demonstrated in a scientific experiment and now published on. That bees have culture. They can learn from one another. We'll be talking about that too. So don't go away. Everybody, thank you. Thank you for a wonderful stream. Thank you for your support, for your enthusiasm, for your questions, for your moderation, moderators. Thank you, raiders and followers and cheerers and lurkers. Thank you, everybody. And let's go see what's up with science streams. See you there, everybody. Let's do it. Let's do it right now.